Podcast 68, brought to you tonight in part by Dynamic Discs, Be Dynamic, Discraft Discs, the world leader in disc sports, and Daredevil Discs.
Hi, Johnny.
Hi, Terry.
Happy New Year, everyone. As Johnny has just done, he opened the show, letting you know we're here for podcast number 68. This is, of course, Smashbox TV. We're here in 2016. And
Are we? It's super, been so long.
It's been so long. Well,
I got this from last year.
It looks good. You definitely should sport that.
I would, but no one would be able to see it.
So we are here, of course, 2016. We hope everyone had a safe and happy new year, including your time spent with loved ones and family, friends. Some people maybe you don't see as often as you'd like, or maybe people you see just often enough.
Just enough.
Whatever the case might be. Hopefully you had some good holidays, plenty of food and good spirits and good fun out there, and we're glad to be here. It's 2016. A theme of the night for me for a few of our trivia questions might be some stats and details from 2015. Ooh. So there's a little, you know, just somewhat of a sneak peek or a little sneak preview. I've actually prepared, I would say, a few details that could be considered questions, and I already have the answers even in everything. So we're already ahead of where we were in 2015.
We started with the sponsors.
Wow.
We've got our questions lined up.
We've got guests lined up. We even have guests potentially lined up for the next 2 to 3 weeks.
2016, the year of preparedness.
Don't get ahead of yourself.
Okay, January, the month of preparedness.
The first 3 weeks of it.
Okay, we'll go that far.
So it should be a really good time. Of course, we hope that you can go out there and share the link with everyone. Let everyone know we are live right now. It gives you a greater chance to win things because most of the giveaways we do are live on the Tuesday Night Podcast. But if you're taking this in, whether you're out, you know, fulfilling a New Year's resolution or working out, you're hitting the treadmill or the gym or mowing a lawn somewhere. No?
No.
You could be mowing a lawn.
Hitting my kids.
Yes, you could. Wow.
No, I bring that up because you had a little back and forth with some Minnesota guys over Adrian Peterson this past weekend.
It's
just a funny conversation to get into. Like, anybody can support that, and it's just you had a couple people, you know, get down on you.
Worked up.
A little worked up.
I've learned that whether it's fair or not, sometimes when I speak, it can get people riled up. Sometimes that may be intentional.
Yeah, it is.
Sometimes it's not, but and really? By all means, I've got two beautiful, amazing children that are
same
4
here.
And 7, and I don't think child abuse is a funny subject. However,
sometimes it is.
Adrian Peters, we're not even going to get into it again. way too many. Congrats to the Minnesota Vikings.
Yes,
I will say that.
Definitely.
We're all in the playoffs if you care about football.
The better team won. Let's put
sure,
it that way.
That night. So
that night, correct.
So anyway, we do appreciate everyone. We're going to have Dynamite join us here in just a few moments. And also we're going to have...
Go ahead.
Also, we're going to have Catrina Allen, Paul Ulibarri. They're going to be joining us on the show. Zoe is with us in spirit. She's out traveling around, being the vagabond. Is that a good word for her?
Yeah, that's a nice way to...
Free-spirited.
Free-spirited. Vagabond's a nice way to put homeless person, I think.
Okay. Well, free-spirited traveler. How about that?
Yes. She's getting ready for the 2016 season.
She is. She said she's learning how to work a camera.
Yep, she's
and
got
edit
footage and editing, and she's working on pieces for us, so it should be really good.
Zotron is going to be coming to a town, running through a town near you.
Yeah, probably
at this rate. So love out there to Zotron, and like I said, we've got some great guests lined up in the next few weeks as well, and we'll talk about them a little bit later. So,
you know,
for
what?
Now,
we're going to throw everybody a loop.
What?
We always do our giveaways late in the show. And it's not...
It keeps them, you know, sitting on the edge of their seat just waiting.
But we're going to give away some discs from one of our sponsors right away. Right now, before we talk to Dana, before we get into any guests, let's get those early birds some action. Some of the kids that maybe go to sleep at 9:30. You know,
well.
Dana just puts them out, you know, his soothing voice just, you know, eases them to sleep. So we're going to give away a pair of Discraft roaches right away.
All right. That's fair enough. Thank you to Discraft, the world leader in disc sports. They've been supporting us, and we're going to have some big news and announcements coming from Keith Murray in the next couple of weeks from them as well.
Yep.
So let's see what you got.
So for a pair of Discraft roaches, we are going to take the very first answer I see.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
That's correct. That answers the question, how many podcasts did we do in 2015? How many podcasts? That does not include events. Tournament podcasts, yes. But not tournament rounds. So not our live broadcasts on the course. These are our strict Terry and John, or Terry on the road, or John and...
Ooh.
Nobody.
So not right so far, yeah. But some good guesses. In 2015...
There it is.
Christopher
Furr.
With the correct answer of 58.
58. So Christopher Fowler, please reach out to one Terry Miller on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or swipe him right, and he will get you, get him your details. He'll get those shipped out to you within the next 2 months. And no. You've been pretty good with that.
I think there's one or two that are still out there. I think I need to pass on some information to one of our sponsors to fulfill it. Yep. So that's still me in the middle. But for the most part, I think I'm pretty well caught up. And if not, just send me another polite message. Beat me over the head with it. Yep. We'll get it out to you.
Let's see here. Christopher, let's make sure we didn't miss one.
I was watching pretty intently.
Yep. We were both watching. Awesome. So, Christopher Fowler, reach out to Terry. Get that stuff. Now... our favorite segment, our favorite person. Yeah, he's our favorite.
Maybe yours.
He's one of my favorites. He's one of my favorites in life.
Okay. I think you need...
Boom goes the dynamite.
Dynamite.
What's up, boys? Terry, I'm just going to stop you right now. If you're going to be hurtful and say mean things, I'm just going to click hang up.
Well, because that's what you're here to do? You're here to go out on the bash train? Is that what your plan is?
Let's do it.
I mean, everybody talked. I know we talked about it, and just in general, people are saying, you know, that Dynamite has let a little loose here once in a while, and they're not used to it. So when we talk about boom goes the Dynamite,
yeah,
it's
I
getting
feel
real.
Like, I only had to do that because of your the way you were broaching subjects. You were setting me up. You lit the fuse, so to speak.
All right.
But glad to be here. Happy 2016, boys. I missed you last week. I was ready. I was rip raring ready to go.
As was I. So. That's just one guy who wasn't, but the rest of us were. I know I've caught up with you a little bit, but good holidays, good times. First Christmas with a newborn. Everything go well?
Oh yeah, you know it was good. You know, got her off her sleep schedule a little bit, but otherwise, other than that, a lot of fun. You know, a lot of little presents and toys and stuff from family members. So. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Busy.
All right.
Very busy.
Have you gotten to the point now where you just kind of, your parents ask you, hey, what do you want for Christmas this year? And now that you have a kid, you're just, it's so much easier to just be like, just get Edith something. Just put some money into a college account. I don't really need, like, what do you ask for Christmas for these days anymore?
We asked for baseboards and trim for our house.
I just put up 2 rooms worth of baseboard and trim.
Really?
Just baseboard. Then I had to sand the trim because we didn't replace the door trim. Sand it, then degloss it, then paint it, then paint it, then paint it, and then paint 3 to 4 layers of paint to cover some old wood baseboard. Wow. Some old wood.
Sounds like cheap paint. I'm no Bob Vila, but that sounds like cheap paint.
No, it was good paint. Okay. It was good paint.
All right.
Just, yeah. We skipped the primer part, which I think is a big thing. We could have put some good primer on, and that might have cut down 1, maybe 2 layers, but we just went with the primer and paint mix, which is good, but doesn't quite cover like you need to. So it's the varnished, you know? So
sounds like you saved a couple bucks and added on a couple extra hours of work.
We did, yeah, a little bit of elbow grease there, but, you know. So we're gonna cut Dane out for Bob Vila next. And so.
Whatever happened to Ty Pennington? Anyone? Anyone?
He had a couple drunk driving things way back in the day, and he kind of vanished. Huh. I don't know. I don't have cable, so I don't know.
So he wasn't allowed to move that bus anymore?
He was not allowed to move that bus.
Huh, okay. That show seemed to just disappear.
Yeah.
Anyway, go on. So, Dana, we all know there hasn't been too much action going on in disc golf. Of course, there's some C tiers and some smaller tournaments going on literally around the globe. So there are some events, but naturally with this the season and the holidays and the colder weather, especially in the north, and you know, more than half of the country, just not as much organized sanctioned golf. I think it's we're getting to that ice bowl season, we're getting to some toy drives, coat drives, charity fundraisers, indoor putting has, you know, taken off throughout the country. But did you find anything that you can report back to us on?
I mean, there was a couple tournaments, nothing really. I figured Spike Heiser would have ran a tournament Friday, Saturday, Sunday, yeah. three C tiers. But looks like he took the weekend off, and there was just a couple C tiers, B tier down in Florida. Nothing really to write home about. None of the real big hitters played down in Florida. Calvin Heimberg took down the victory, but other than that, it was very quiet weekend, and I imagine most people just relaxing at home. And I know in the Midwest we had some ice and snow later last week, and a lot of the courses tee pads were iced over, so I think a lot of people just hanging out at their home courses, maybe catching around if they wanted to get out in the cold.
Now you bring up an interesting point. I know that you and your guests had asked earlier in the weekend as to if some tees were cleared out at your local course. You, like us in Wisconsin, had received some snow. What I think is interesting to share with the rest of our podcast listeners from all over the country is the responsibilities of tee pad clearing. And there's a couple different ways that I can go at this. But for starters, you always want to say, if you're first to the course or if you think you're going to be first to the course, make sure you bring a shovel. Because if you're the first one on that tee pad and you can clear the snow off before, it's just like you're in your driveway. Everybody hates it when there's a set of tracks that drive over it, and you're trying to get it as clean as possible. Same thing goes with a tee pad. So if you're an early riser, you're one of the first out to the course, always have a shovel within your group.
Or bring a freezer bag full of salt as well.
That certainly helps as well. Let me interject, make sure
it is salt that is safe for concrete,
yes.
Because there is some stuff that will really degrade,
yep,
the tee pads, and you know, don't want that. So please make sure it's the appropriate salt
and water softener salt. I've seen it used, although not ideal.
No.
I have seen it used in a pinch. But so if you're one of the first ones out there, you know, that's kind of our PSA on that. However, what my real question was, what do you think the percentage is of parks departments that actually are the ones that are in charge of clearing tee pads? And I say this because I saw one of your local courses, the parks department was mentioned. I'm thinking, what parks department shovels tee pads? Is that something common down there?
Definitely not. Most of the courses in Joliet are in poor areas. They don't really have it's not a great park district. I'm sorry, but the Joliet park district does not care about disc golf.
Wow. And you, you say I rip on you guys, but go on.
So those courses are not getting cleared off by the park district. Shanahan, where I live, has a pretty good park district, but they definitely are not going out and cleaning the tee pads. The course that you were mentioning is Delwood, mm-hmm, which is in Lockport. It's a beautiful park, and the cooperation between the course designer and some of the locals in the park district has been simply amazing.
Hmm.
They do an incredible amount of work out there, whether it's wood chips, rock paths, like on muddy spots, clearing out trees, and they went out and cleaned up tee pads that were, from what I heard, they were pretty nasty. I think some people had played on them when they had snow and ice on them and really compacted it. So I don't think it was a quick little shovel job, but, you know, chipping ice off and everything. So I would say that's a pretty rare thing for most disc golf courses, is seeing the park district go out and actually clean the tee pads off. Should that be, do you guys think that should be something that a park district might you know, or should we just be happy to have a course?
I think in a place, maybe, I mean, I hate to throw this out there, like a Milwaukee where it's pay to play. I don't, I could see an argument being made where, yes, that should be on them. You're paying for year-round access to the park. I could see them going out there. I don't think they do it, yeah. But...
But
most other parks, no.
What would even be the expectations? That's another way to look at it, too. So they may say, okay, we'll take care of the tee pads. You guys still have all these golfers coming out. You're paying for a year-round pass. It's pay to play. However, you know, they're not going to... What if they don't get out there till 2 o'clock after every snowstorm? By that time, there may be dozens of people that have already tried to play. Yeah. And we all know, even in a pay-to-play scenario, more often than not, there's still a local club. There's still some local diehards that take on a good majority of work and or light maintenance. And I think you can throw, snow removal under that. So I guess my question, and I know we have got a large contingency of Minnesota golfers. I saw gasoline in a match. I'm not sure that's the answer that would work.
Yeah.
I've never thought of that out there.
I have these, I believe they're called Yak Tracks that I use. This one's actually a little bit beat up. You can see it's missing a couple of the pins, but these are really nice on concrete tee pads for throwing and driving. I'll say this, you have to be careful to try not to put too much power behind it because they'll still give you a little bit of slip and you'll actually maybe blow them out if they're not the really strong kind. But they do help. So if you want to do a bunch of standstill shots, these are perfect for that. Forehand, things of that nature so you don't slip and fall.
You can find Yak Tracks obviously online or at like an REI. They usually range anywhere from $15 to $30. I'd say the $20 to $30 mark is more often the price point you're going
to
see them at.
Yeah, they're about $20 to $30 depending on the type you get. These are actually some really nice ones. Some of them have the I've seen some actually with built out of chain on the bottom. I don't know how good those are on concrete tee pads. I could see that kind of maybe chipping it up a little bit. But yeah, these Yak Tracks, I also use them to shovel and snow blow in icy conditions.
And just to be clear, Yak Tracks is not a current sponsor of our broadcast, but we would,
if they would like,
certainly
to be.
Listen in. We would love to talk to them. What a segue. Let's talk a little bit about sponsorships. I know it's going to be a hot topic as people continue to move into this season. Just a few days ago, it was talked about Drew Gibson. He was one of the guys that I know has been discussed. And we're seeing lots of players put up a post saying, hey, I'm sticking with a team, or I'm moving to team X, Y, and Z, or I'm moving and I haven't announced where to yet. Dana, you obviously were with Prodigy last year, and now your new opportunity has come along to be with Disc Mania and Disc Golf Park. What have you got anything else out there that you can share that's maybe not common knowledge but that's yet still not a secret? Anything you can share out there, or any surprises?
Not particularly. For our friends that aren't on Facebook, Drew Gibson announced that he is no longer going to be with Innova. He left it open-ended, did not say where he would be playing next year. My bet is somewhere within the Trilogy family, which would be Dynamic Discs, Latitude, or Westside Discs.
That's not what the online consensus is.
What did they say?
I was looking at there's a thread on Disc Golf Course Review 2016 sponsorship changes. Almost everybody's convinced he's going to Disc Mania.
Which is a very valid consideration, because as I learned with Simon last year, and we're seeing more and more of these players. Dana, I think you're privy to this too. We're seeing that some players are being forced, so to speak, to not just be under the global Innova umbrella, but under specifically Disc Mania versus Innova.
Yeah. We saw that with Simon. I don't know the specifics on it, but he definitely was throwing an all Disc Mania bag this last year. Mm-hmm. He had dropped the Firebird and picked up the FD3. But I saw that on about possibility of Drew going to Disc Mania, but I want to say I don't think he is, because he tagged UC in his thank you post.
Oh.
So that would lead me to believe that he might be going elsewhere. Again, that's speculation, but I'm assuming it's going to be in the Trilogy family, and where he ends up, I'm not quite sure. I do know Latitude seems to be... Latitude and Dave Felberg seem to offer very good deals for players, whether it's discs or monthly stipends or large signing bonuses. Latitude, they pay you.
Okay. Well, with that detective work, maybe you should be up in Manitoba. So what I will say.
No, that would be putting somebody else's, like a manufactured disc in Drew's bag and then pulling it out and be like, this is where you're going.
So with that being said, we are going to have the exclusive reveal. Oh, yeah. The exclusive reveal of where Drew is going, which is pretty exciting. Obviously,
is he going to like open up a box that has balloons and they're a certain manufacturer, you know?
Open up a smash like box?
A gender reveal party, you know?
That could be. I can't give you all the secrets, but we do know that Drew is going to join us on the show 2 weeks from tonight. He's going to be talking about some sponsorship. We also have Ricky Singleton next week. He's going to be joining us on the show. He's from Daredevil Disc, and he's going to be not only talking about sponsorship, but some of the big things that Daredevil has going on. So there may be some tie-ins. I mean, anything's possible out there, but just let you know, next week we'll be having Ricky talk about Daredevil Disc and their potential sponsorship options.
Awesome.
As
now,
well.
Make sure when you say Ricky, you say Ricky Singleton. Correct. So we don't get, you know, the Ricky, the Rickster, the firecrack putter man, Ricky Wysocki confused with Ricky Singleton and Daredevil this. Now, Daredevil's a sponsor. What is, they're out of Canada?
Hey, they are. And I'll be the first to admit, one of the reasons they reached out to us, they wanted to kind of spread their love and spread the knowledge of what they have going on. I think a lot of people are really interested to find out more about them, what they have going on, and they thought, you know, kind of just being here on Smashbox would help kind of get the word out there. So we're flattered by that.
It definitely
will. And we're glad to have him. So Ricky's going to give us all of the details. I had a brief conversation with him last night, and he's excited to be on the show next week. So
nice.
Stay
tuned,
I've seen, Dana.
A number of locals with some Daredevil discs being thrown around or putted around. Ricky Singleton is nearby me across the border in the state of Indiana. Mm-hmm. And so that could have something to do with it. But I've seen a few of them fly around. I haven't had a chance to chuck one or really fondle any of the plastic yet. So I guess I'll have to tune in next week to learn a little bit more.
You're going to hear it right here. Now, you just a moment ago did reference Ricky Wysocki. We saw as the new year came in, Rick put together a couple videos. Can you want to explain those to the world?
Rick is becoming a social media guru.
I'm worried about my job.
Yeah, he was notorious for having a few accounts, I believe, because did he lose an account at one point, or he lost it and he's created a new one? And
yeah,
cute kid,
Ricky, he's awesome.
So tell everyone out there, in case somebody hadn't seen them, I believe I saw the first one. I know there was a second one. I mistakenly hadn't clicked on it yet. But tell everyone what Ricky released in the last week or so for the new year.
On New Year's Eve, he was talking about this is how Ricky Wysocki rings in the new year, something like that. And he says, I throw a spark. Have you ever seen a sparkler putt? And he tapes a sparkler to his putter, and then it's dark out, and he jams. I think he makes the putt, and then puts out another video and puts a firecracker on his disc.
I saw the result of that.
Yeah. I didn't see that one.
Yeah, he posted a picture. It wasn't a video. It was just a picture of his disc. And it was black on the top, but lots of char marks. And I think there was a hole in it. Okay. Fairly certain.
Ricky, he hasn't been known in the past as someone who has been on Facebook or social media a lot. It seems as lately he's been really making a push on social media, using a lot of hashtags. Don't ask him to explain what hashtags are.
He doesn't need to know. As long as they're there and they're clever.
Search hashtag Socky Bomb if you guys want to follow along with the Rick action. But I think what I'm most looking forward to from Ricky is his he's seen a movie tonight and he's promised to review it. So
did he say what he's going to see?
What's the banking movie?
Oh yeah, yep.
The Big Short.
The Big Short.
Is that the Big Short. He's going to see The Big Short, and he's promised a review. So
wow. Well, maybe if the timing's right, he might be logged in right around the time of our after show. We may get the exclusive review right here on the after show. After
show. Do you think that's something that Latitude is starting to push on him? I mean, he, as we all said, he didn't do this in the past. He's not what we call a natural in front of the camera. He's working at it. He's getting better. Is this something that, you know, Dave and Latitude is pushing on to kind of help push and promote their product?
I would say there's probably a push from Felberg and Latitude for Ricky to be more social media savvy. But it's really if you think about it, it's a smart move for him. If he can figure things out, and it opens a lot more doors, and it promotes himself and obviously his sponsors, making him more valuable, other than being, you know, the second best disc golfer in the world right now. So, I'm interested to see how Ricky improves over the years. And one of the that gets me thinking, one of the most well-spoken disc golfers we all know is Nate Doss. He gives incredibly great thank you speeches. If you're interviewing him, he gives thoughtful answers. But Terry, you know this, Nate wasn't always that good. And, I'm flashing back to the very first ever National Tour clinic. And I may have talked about this in the past, so for you hardcore smashies, I'm sorry, I can't remember, but it was at the Memorial, 2005.
It was one of my early memorials, so maybe it was in 2005, but my very first memorial.
It was the year after he won.
Okay, makes sense.
One of his world championships.
Yeah,
but,
we were all there. Yeah. And he just.
He was a younger fella.
He was a man.
I can give you guys the quote.
Okay.
Nate, his section of the clinic was upshots.
Yep, approaching.
And,
yep.
He just gets up there and he's like, you know, like when I won my world championship, I just tried to throw everything in. That's verbatim.
Yeah.
But add in a young Nate Doss Cali accent.
Yeah.
And that was it. He's like, I just tried to throw it in, and you know, if I didn't, I would just putt it in.
Yeah.
Me, I can remember looking to Nick Rapp, who I was traveled to the event
Nick.
With. Is this guy serious? That's all you got to do?
Yeah, I know. I remember him holding up a disc, be like, you just got to put this into this.
Yeah.
And just because I think someone asked him about his putting, and he's like, you just got to put this into this. And like, it's
like that was it?
Like, that's what you got to do.
Yeah.
And it was hilarious because you're right. He had this whole SoCal attitude, and just it was one of the first NT clinics.
It was the first.
So there wasn't a lot of preparedness by anybody. And I think Barry was there, and Val might have been there too.
I know Yeti was there.
Yeah, it was. I remember because Terry and I were sitting probably right behind you guys, looking at each other like, "This is gold.
Yeah,
this is gold."
So Nate has come a long way. We've reached out to Nate, had a good conversation with him. I'll just say real quickly, and he's talked about possibly being on here a little more frequently.
Yeah.
You know, maybe even a more regular segment with him. You know, obviously well traveled. He's one of the only three people in the world that have three or more world titles to their name. Kenny
and a U.S. title.
And a U.S. title, but you know, Kenny, Nate Doss, and Paul McBeth, the only people to have won three worlds or more.
Men.
In the men's open division.
Thank you.
So clearly, he would be a great resource to have on the show, and we're going to be having Val on more frequently. Go on.
With that said, Rick, you know. Ricky's just starting to embrace the social media side of things, and Ricky is good at anything he does. So I imagine he's probably going to be a smooth talking Nate Doss in the next few years. So,
well, I think amongst our top players, you see Yuli, who we're going to have on here shortly. You see Ricky Wysocki and Paul McBeth. All three of them are just naturally gifted and talented, and it seems like whatever they pick up, they're very competitive. for starters. They, you know, the second they pick up something, they want to beat somebody else at it.
Yeah.
And I feel like all three of them, you know, are kind of cut from that exact same cloth in their competitiveness, and there's just their natural athleticism to go out and excel at things. So it's pretty cool to see. Real quick, before we let you go, Dana, one of the things that some people may or may not realize when talking about sponsorships, when talking about things like social media and your prowess and everything out there, we're seeing a development, or we're seeing a new policies, new procedures by brands and companies that, as Johnny was saying, they're encouraging, they're almost requiring their players to go out and do certain things, whether it's talk about, you know, a new release or make a post about it or describe something about it.
Which is way different than in a lot of other professional sports, where they give these rookies and these young guys clinics on social media. They're like, don't post unless it's a promoted tweet or it goes through your social media manager. These guys have none of that.
Yeah.
You know, our guys, I
feel like I don't like the forced feel of some of the companies. You can tell where they're players. It's I'm meeting my quota and,
sure,
oh yeah, blah blah blah, this disc, and it's, I don't know, I feel like more, I like to, whoever I'm with or whatever I'm doing, I like to promote it more naturally and not have it so force fed, but yeah, it is an important thing for a player to do these days, and it can, you know, help somebody get a sponsorship deal. You don't necessarily have to be the 1040 rated player to make a huge, huge impact. Of course, being the best player in the world, that's great. But if you can speak and talk on social media, that's a big bonus for a company.
Yeah, and I think just seeing that advancement, seeing that in contracts or, you know, listed somewhere as, whether it's, like you said, required or strongly suggested or whatever the case might be, I think that's awesome to see. And we see that some of our players are more adverse to that, or, you know, take to that a little bit better, I should say. And some players, like you said, it may come off as a little bit forced. But nonetheless, I think it's great to see, and I think it just talks about the change, you know, in what we've been seeing in sports and professional sports. I think it's awesome. So,
yeah. I know you guys are itching to get to Cat and Paul, but a couple other players that are switching teams.
Mm-hmm.
James Proctor from California.
Yep.
He has been Prodigy sponsored for the last 2 years. He's got a collegiate national title under his belt. He's definitely a top 20 talent. He's one of the best putters in the world. I've heard Nico rant and rave about how good of a putter James Proctor is, and I've watched James play, and there's many videos of him. He's a very, very good player. He also has not announced where he will be playing. My guess, again, would be somewhere within the Trilogy family. But you never know. You know, in California, Innova, but again,
Legacy, Aroby, Whammo.
With Latitude Pain, I would assume it's he's probably going to go that way. Also, Matt Dollar, longtime Innova sponsored pro, who's another tremendous putter. Very good at throwing overhands, if you guys don't know. But most people, when you hear Matt Dollar's name, it's synonymous with thumbers.
Mm-hmm.
And, so it'll be interesting to see for Matt how his game changes, you know, how easy it is to switch out a thumber disc, because he's got these Innova Firebirds, or FLs, tuned in insanely well. So that's another big move. And again, he announced that he won't be with Innova and did not say where he is going. So I'm assuming, since those three guys announced they're leaving their sponsors and are not, and didn't announce where they were going, I feel like they're going in the same direction.
With someone who's left now Prodigy and moving on over to another team, Alex Geisinger. Geisinger, for those who don't know, he's not a household name. We kind of beat that to death, but it's true. He's not yet, and we saw him obviously perform really well at the USDGC this year. He's from Minnesota, so kind of up in our neck of the woods for the three of us here on the show right now. He throws a mile, and there's
2 miles.
2 miles to be exact. And if there is one of the few people out there in the world right now that can certainly challenge Simon Lizotte's world distance record, Alex Geisinger's on top of that list.
Him, Wiggins, and Simon are really the three guys that you would pick for another to break the record.
Yeah, at this point. Yeah. So Alex Geisinger has been, like we said, he's been with Prodigy. Now he's going to be with Innova.
Yeah.
We'll see how he makes those adjustments.
I played a practice round with Geisinger at the USTGC, and I'd heard about him and never really, you know, seen him play on in person. And he's incredible. Like, he's very strong built, and the disc just comes out so fast and so hard. I remember we're playing with my buddy Nick Austin, and Alex threw the shot, and Nick's like, that was an X1, a Prodigy X1, and that's a super overstable disc, and Alex just made it fly like like nothing. He's like, Nick's like, Nick has 500 foot power, and legit 500 foot power, and he's like, I can't get that thing to fly like that. I'm like, no, I'm like, he's real, and he can throw far. So he's very, very raw with his power. I don't know if he has a 360 or anything. He definitely has not been out at any big D in the desert events. So it might be one of those things where he goes, if he makes it out there, he goes out there and learns, and then comes back in a year and possibly breaks the record. But I would, outside of his raw power, I would say he probably needs a little tutelage in the distance, because it is a little different when you're going for that crazy desert max D. But on flat land, he just a regular golf shot, he throws so far.
He does, so. And he gets it done because he can putt. And when you have someone like Cale Laviska talking you up and somewhat of a friend and a mentor and a partner in crime up there in Minnesota, teammates, all that other stuff that they've been, he's in good company up there. And when you get Cale's stamp of approval of knowing what you're doing something right. I know Alex for the longest time had the fastest miles per hour speed on the radar gun up at the airborne shop when that was intact up there in Minnesota. So raw power, we've had him on the show, super great guy. He's still really young, and if he can get out there and tour a little bit more, which I think might be in his plans, I think you're going to hear his name a lot more. So mark it right here on Smashbox, folks, Alex Geisinger.
All right, what other names you got for us before we kick you off the air?
I saw a couple names going to Prodigy: Kobe Juice, Geis, Colin Forehand. I think they're both.
Is that really his name, Colin Forehand?
What?
Is that really his last name, Forehand, or is that just what people call him?
Have you been hiding under a rock, Johnny?
I honestly don't know.
He doesn't
know. All the cool disc golf names?
No.
This is definitely, he's got a great last name here, but they both have signed with Prodigy, and I believe they're both they're living in Asheville right now, I want to say. Coming from Florida. But and then other than that, off the top of my head, I'm thinking about Paige. I don't have any new news. I don't know if Terry has anything he can share, but I would say since we have not heard any official announcements or anything, that she's still with Prodigy, or it's still up in the air. Terry, can you add anything?
I can't add anything. I know.
All I know is until I hear, I don't know anything more than I knew last week. But as far as I know, she's still with Prodigy. So there's been no announcements or anything. So she's a good player to have no matter where she is.
Yeah. So just something that, something I guess we'll have to follow along like everybody else. And I'm sure when the announcement comes, she'll make her way to, the old smash box.
That's what they do.
She better.
That's what they do. I don't know. Anyway, a couple of people, before we let you go, a couple of people asking about your schedule. Is your schedule determined? Obviously, you've got an infant in the household. What's your 2016 going to look like?
Well, unfortunately, I'm going to be missing out on the Memorial this year. It's just a little too much. like you said, with an infant in the house, to leave for a week or 7 or 8 days, which I would have normally done for the memorial. So I'm deciding to sit that one out. I am going to play in the world tour at La Mirada.
The weekend after.
What's that?
The weekend after.
Yes, the weekend after. That's okay. I can make that a much shorter trip. It's only a 3-day event. I can fly out, get a day of practice in, and fly back Sunday. Other than that, during the school year, I'm not going to be doing a whole lot of traveling. I'm planning on attending the St. Jude event again. But once summer hits, planning on hitting the Disc Golf Pro Tour. I will be at all of the events, and I'm looking forward to playing. Hopefully, we'll be doing some podcast action, maybe step in with Terry and do a little bit of live commentary here and there when I can, if you'll have me. I mean, I don't know if you got anyone lined up, but
I'm taking applications. We're taking applications.
Taking apps. Yeah. Otherwise, I don't. My West Coast swing is up in the air. It seems like I'm not going to be able to make it out to the Beaver State Fling if I want to do the Pro Tour. It's just Beaver State Fling ends, and then 10 days later is the Vibram Open, and that's a lot to do, and especially if I was to leave Ashley home with the baby or to take them with, that's a lot of money and a lot of traveling for Ashley and the baby. So
You got a new job. You're rich now. You got a new job in disc golf.
I was going to say, or get the traveling in before they're 2 or 3 or whatever it is, because then they don't have to pay for another seat. They can sit on laps. One or the other. So,
yeah, I was thinking about pitching an idea to Ashley and Steve Dodge. Maybe she could go on the pro tour and babysit.
Yeah.
You know, get paid.
Have you run this by her yet?
Yeah.
No, not at all.
Okay.
Congratulations. It's going to be Edith and the Brinster kids.
Yeah.
Maybe Avery's.
Exactly.
So. Yeah, all right, Dana.
I am signed up for the Glass Blown Open as well.
Awesome.
And I'm not 100% that I'm going to attend, unfortunately, because it is during the school year, and you know, that's one where you're going to be gone, you know, 5 to 7 days, and that's a lot. I would love to attend it and get back to Emporia, because that's an incredible town. They love disc golf there, but man, well, I wish these tournaments were in the summer.
FYI, Dutch says that he needs a babysitter, and we know there's a lot of those Dutch kids.
Yeah, so. Batman.
Batman. That could be some serious cash, honestly.
Yeah,
think about it. She could make more babysitting the Napier kids then probably playing probably more than any of the pros make. So
hey, so, there we go. And then I could drive around some of the equipment for Steve Dodge, get paid for that, maybe. I don't know.
That's right. Pick up side
jobs.
We can
live on the pro tour.
There you go, Dana. All right.
All right. Well, I just got a message from Catrina Allen to say, I said she's going to be up in just a few minutes, and she says, tell Dana to stop blabbing. So I guess that's your cue. Dana, you're out.
Out.
See you, buddy.
Thanks, Dana.
And, of course, our wonderful weekly segment with Dana Mitvicki. Dana usually bringing us news and updates from around the tour and the stats that we like to see coming off the PDGA website and beyond. Dana will be getting back at it as more and more action picks up. And I was just out on the PDGA calendar taking a look late last night as well as today. And as expected, it's starting to fill up. You know, it starts out with your majors and your national tours and your A tiers. But now every day you're seeing more and more tournaments are getting added to that calendar. And it's getting more and more intense. And it should be a really good time, obviously, in 2016.
Well, I saw what you did with the Wisconsin state calendar. And there was hardly a free weekend in there.
No, there's really not. Somebody's running something all the time. And speaking of playing, just about every weekend of the year.
There is no off season.
No off season for these guys. We've got Kat and Paul. Welcome to the show, guys.
good entrance.
That's great.
Perfect.
That's great. Tennessee right. was just hit with an earthquake.
How you guys doing tonight?
Hey guys, what's up?
Scoot over.
Everybody wants to see you. Scooch.
Get all right, close. We got it together now.
There you go. So, for the starters, Happy New Year to you two. How you guys doing?
Good.
Now, you guys are in Tennessee. I had mistakenly thought that you were out in Arizona, but instead you're in Tennessee for, what, another couple weeks?
No, for probably we're leaving next Monday.
Oh, okay. And where are you headed?
To Arizona.
Okay. So I may run into you. A little spoiler alert for everybody here. I just confirmed with Dave Felberg earlier today that I'm going to be heading out to see you guys at the Maricopa Open. Does that sound?
Yeah.
Sound
yeah.
right?
Yeah. Maricopa Open.
Okay. Well, I'll see
I think
you
it's
guys.
The first A-tier of the year. So.
Yes. Very exciting. I know that Felberg and Hav and some others are at the helm, so it should be kind of interesting to see how everyone copes with running a big event in the beginning of the season and. I'm ready for some Arizona weather. Now, what have you guys been up to in Tennessee and the surrounding area?
Oh, well, we just got back to Tennessee. We're actually visiting her family for the holidays up in Minnesota.
Okay.
So we got a taste of your guys' weather up there.
Oh, did you like it? Did you get out and play in it at all?
Oh, no.
Yes, he actually snowblowed the driveway.
Oh, yeah, that was my plane.
Yeah. Did he do
and
a good...
I lost my phone in the snow, so that
oh,
was good.
First, did you find the phone? And second, did you do a good job snowblowing? Did Dad have to go out afterwards?
Snowblowing, I mean, that was the first time I've done that in, 9 years, so...
Yeah. Now, you guys are probably the biggest road warriors, at least as a couple out there in disc golf. Talk a little bit about how many events you played and
how many weekends you missed.
Yeah, maybe that's an easier way to look at it. How many weekends did you not play this year?
I'm not exactly sure. I know I got 42 events in last year.
Okay.
Couple two and ones,
sure.
Saturday, Sunday events. I know that the GBO helps out with that because they have the one round C tiers or whatever, so it looks like I played a lot more than I really did.
Yeah, you can play 3 rounds before you've had breakfast, and then
exactly.
Yeah.
Now, Kat, you had a pretty tall task in somehow coming off of 2014, which was this amazing year that you were just so successful in. Did you have any pressures moving into 2015 to try and keep that momentum going?
No, and I actually just made a post about this. I actually felt stronger and better than I did going into the year before. And then I think I was hole 6 or 7 at Vegas. I was playing a practice round. Threw my drive and went down to grab my bag, and my hand was covered with blood, mm-hmm. and my finger had just split open. And it kind of, I had to tape it, and the tape got in my head. I didn't know if I wasn't putting well because of the tape or because I sucked at putting or what was going on. And it kind of took over, like I said in my post, all the way until I got to Europe. Somehow I found some confidence and got back in the groove a little bit.
Yeah, I saw your post saying just that. When you went over there, was it maybe a fresh start or just maybe different expectations, anything like that?
I don't know. I just love the courses there and how professional everything's ran, and I think I just feel comfortable over there for some reason more than I do here. I don't know why, but...
Now, when you guys are traveling around, is it... Well, I know the answer. It's usually the two of you, but occasionally you pick up a straggler here and there. Who else were you with this year?
There are kids, and
okay.
It's Drew Gibson.
Yep.
And Richard Kielander.
Now, Richard...
it's a big kid.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
What was Richard's... I don't want to say his objective. How did he go about this year? Because was he here on just a for-fun visa, or does he constitute it as work, or how was he able to pull that off?
I'm not European. I have no idea.
All right, so you guys were carting around an illegal immigrant for the...
Yeah, possibly. I'm not sure.
Obviously, a ton of golf. You guys literally threw thousands of shots. Any couple of shots that maybe really stick out in your head from 2015, whether it may be good, maybe bad, maybe you threw them or maybe you watched them get thrown, but anything stick out for either of you in 2015 if you had to pick the top couple shots?
I had, I guess I had one of my most memorable aces last year. I played a tournament, the Tree Bash.
Okay.
And that was in, like, my hometown. And early in my career, it, like, ate me up these courses. They're up in Flagstaff.
Yep.
Maybe you're familiar with those courses mm-hmm. from the Worlds
yep.
and stuff, but there was one hole in particular that's like a par four uphill, and I threw a really good shot and aced that hole, and I ended up winning the tournament, and it was like kind of a little monkey off my back for my local scene, you know.
Nice.
Yeah, for sure. And now there's NAU. Now Snowball. This is kind of a side topic. Snowball's course exist at all anymore, or is that completely a was that temporary just for 03 and 05 Worlds?
No, I'm pretty sure it exists. Like I said, that was the first time I've played in Flagstaff in years. Okay. And usually for that tournament, we play Snowball, but this year we didn't, so I couldn't give you a 100% answer on that one.
All right, Kat, any magical moment? And again, maybe it wasn't yours. Maybe you saw something else that you didn't think. Maybe it was a shot by Paul or anyone else. Is there any shot or two that stick out in your mind from 2015?
No, I think just for me personally, my round in Europe on the Beast mm-hmm. at the European Open is the highlight and what I remember from the year the most, I guess.
What was that officially rated? 10?
I don't know. I don't really follow the ratings.
Okay.
It was, in my opinion, the best round I'd ever played. So
yeah,
better than my round that was rated 1058. So I don't.
Okay.
Ratings to me mean.
Yeah.
Sure. Whatever. I certainly remember watching some of the Insider show and them talking about it. Honegger was on there and talking about all the stats and whatnot, and just him reviewing your round and how amazing it was over there. So that's awesome to see. Now, we just talked about it a little bit with Dana, and obviously it's just kind of the talk of the time is sponsorships. And you guys, a few weeks ago, I think one of the two of you or both of you chimed in while we were live saying that you guys are staying put. You're with Prodigy. You want to talk a little bit about your relationship and you know, how you guys have been there from day one and such?
Yeah, no, super excited going into 2016 again with Prodigy. You know, we're under 2-year contract, so I knew that before the year started that I was going to be doing that. And like I said, super excited, proud to be on Team Prodigy, and ready for a successful year. And I might be going to training camp, you know what I mean? I don't know. Berg, they'll let me. I don't know.
They'll let you. Okay.
Wait, are they playing in Cincinnati?
Yeah, Saturday. I'm going to roll up there.
Try to get a ticket?
Maybe.
That'd be awesome.
Very nice. and Kat, go ahead.
Oh, yeah. No, I don't really plan on ever going anywhere. I mean, I'm excited to see where we could go just with how far we've gone in the few years we've been around. It's like an honor just to hear people compare us to the other companies. Mm-hmm. And that's just unbelievable to think back to, you know, when we signed our first contracts. I don't even think we had quite discs yet. I mean, they were being made, but
sure.
And to see now how many discs we have out, go to courses, see people throwing them. I mean, it's incredible, I think.
Speaking of which, I'm going to backtrack a little bit. Did I see the 2014 AM World Women's Champion, Vanessa Van Dyken, added to Prodigy? Just announced, I believe, today. I think I saw that
really?
On the Facebook.
Wow, I missed that. Very nice.
That's what I'm here for, Johnny.
Thanks.
That's what I do. I stalk people on Facebook.
Yeah, you're the best at that.
So, very cool. Now, sorry, just quickly sidetrack. She's traveling around in Europe. Is that... Do you know what she's up to? Is she over there with?
With Seppo.
Seppo,
there,
okay.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay, awesome. Now, there's a lot of talk on the tours, you know, the national tour, the world tour, all the different tours. Obviously, there was kind of a hot button topic just a few days ago or a few weeks ago now regarding the world tour and the women and the exemptions and all the wild card exemption spots or whatever they were called. Kat, do you have any input as to the world tour and what it really means to you, knowing that they're not, you know, explicitly creating a women's division?
At first, when I heard the one division thing, I was a bit confused, and then I just kind of got over it for a while, and then all the official news came out about how everything was actually, you know, what, very recently, and So I just personally messaged UC because I feel close enough to him, and mm-hmm. I just said, what was your decision on not making division for the women? And we talked back and forth, and he was honest and actually replied very quickly. And I respect UC and what he's doing and understand where he's coming from. And I think, although it does kind of suck, like, to not have a women's division, but there's just not enough of us, and I understand that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that we have to be honest with ourselves and tell the women start playing in divisions together. I mean, instead of all the different divisions, that's probably what we'll continue to see if we don't start playing together, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about roughly 7% of our PDGA membership is women. And then when you take that finite amount of women, that very few, select few, and then you can spread it out over, you know, the 15 or 20 different divisions that are ultimately offered, like you're saying, I think there's just a real watering down, so to speak, of competition or of, you know, people playing against one another.
Now, you're exempt from, you've got an exemption for the first World Tour, for the entire season?
I don't know. He just told me I had a wild card and that I had until the 7th to sign up. And so I have decided to play the La Mirada. And then it'll just, for me, be more of what else is going on and the schedule. I'm not going to say I'm not going to go out of my way to play, but I'm, you know, if there's something that makes more sense for me financially, travel-wise, then I'll probably do that.
Of course. Is there a part of you that's excited to play in, like, just the one division, just to kind of compare yourself to some of the people at the time? Or
I mean, back in Arizona, there's not a lot of open women, so I actually normally just play open. Okay. So.
Yeah, and that's what I was just going to say. Clearly, he has these exemptions. Clearly, he has picked the three highest-rated women. If there's any women that can cash in an open, competitive open field, it's the three that he's picked. So there's really no surprise there. I feel like there's absolutely no reason why you wouldn't be able to cash at these events. And I think, like you said, it's going to come down to your financial concerns as to if it makes sense for you to travel elsewhere. Now, I know you and Paul are obviously always traveling together. I think that's going to factor in more than anything. I think we're seeing that with a lot of the couples. I'll use Nate Doss and Valerie Jenkins, for example. You know, these couple, we have so many couples in disc golf, and just the dynamics of it, I think, are kind of what muddies the waters for, you know, these various tours. Is there any thought as to the pro tour? We can move over to that. I mean, a lot of established events kind of just put together to make it officially a tour, but yet time-wise and geographically they make sense. I would assume you guys are excited about that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Super pumped about the pro tour. Like you said, geographically, finally we have a nice little tour, and, you know, Steve Dodge and Nate Honnold, I think, are going to do a great job with their events, along with UC and everybody else who's running their tournaments. So.
Certainly. Now, the American Disc Golf Tour has come about. There's obviously a lot of conversation about it. I think one of the things that continues to loom over the entire conversation is the ESPN component. You know, people, you know, may or may not be skeptical of what all the details of the tournament are, but one of the overshadowing parts is the ESPN3 component. Ricky has been out there. We also heard from Billy Crump. Sounds like Barry Schultz and a few others are getting on board. And I know that's kind of in a iffy time frame, May 14th and 15th, and the Women's Global event. Kat, Paul, do you guys, is it on your radar? I guess that's the easiest way to ask it.
Well, you know, I'd love to support something like that. It's just that I actually had a previous arrangement to go to the Utah Open.
Okay.
Which is actually a non-sanctioned event in between the two national tours, and it's kind of geographically makes a lot of sense for me, and I've done a lot of help with the tournament. Jade Sewell is actually a good up-and-coming tournament director, and I'm really excited to see what he does with his tournaments. Okay. So that's where I'll be.
Okay.
I talked to Billy Crump recently about it, and I got a lot of information about it and stuff, and I told him, you know, if there's anything that I could do to help out from where I am, I'd love to help, you know. Growing the sport in any way, in my opinion, is very important, and so I'm happy to see it for sure.
Okay. Well, speaking of growing the sport, you two were, bless you, you guys were a very large part, and very instrumental in the St. Jude charity event last year that took place. Obviously, enormous success, over, you know, almost $250,000 raised by disc golfers. What was that experience like for you guys, and where do you think we can see it go in 2016?
Well, we actually got to go to Memphis and tour the hospital, and so there was a lot about St. Jude that I didn't know. First of all, I didn't know that there was just one hospital. I just assumed that they were all over the country. And yeah, just to learn about what they do, and it's just kind of a win-win situation. It's a great thing for disc golf, a positive tournament for us, a way for us to all to come together and raise money for the children of St. Jude. And then, of course, you know, the kids also benefit, so.
Now, you guys, Kat, did you raffle off a bag or something like that? I think that was one a good piece of fundraising. You guys got any special things in the works or any plans for how you can contribute and do some fundraising this year? Or is that all secret?
It'll be the same way. And then something that I'd like to remind everybody watching, that you don't necessarily have to play in the tournament to fundraise. You can actually create a page and still fundraise the way you would if you were playing the tournament. So that's something that we are going to try to make a bigger goal of getting more people involved that way. And then, yeah, there are some things going on within all the disc golf companies, but I don't think anything's been announced yet, so I'll just let you guys get excited about that.
Yeah, definitely bigger and better. I think you hit on a great point that some people are confused that you either had to play there or you had to be there, or there were other limitations, and really there wasn't. There's a lot of different ways to donate. We see someone like our...
just first-year confusion.
Yeah.
As we do this more often,
yep,
for any charity, but St. Jude especially, I think more people are going to get on board. You're going to see the fundraising efforts jump significantly this year.
And just letting everyone in on the sweet action, Nate Sexton is hitting it hard already. I see him.
Is he really?
Oh, yeah. He's working with some guys, and he's doing a significant amount of fundraising already. So we see him hitting the ground early.
Someone's asking if Paul can raffle off the Steelers shirt he's wearing. I don't know.
It'd be worth a little more here in a couple of weeks.
I bet you with a $500 contribution to St. Jude, he'd send you that shirt if you guys wanted to do that.
Absolutely. There you absolutely go. And,
we'll force him into
yeah,
it.
Yeah, hopefully Macbeth can match what he did last year. I'm excited to see what he does. I think, what was it, 25,000 or... Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were talking about his five.
I don't think he's rooting for that. I think he's...
How much can you raffle those off for? I'm sure somebody can pay for those.
Oh, that's a good question. Where do you get for some of those trophies?
It was a pretty crazy year. Obviously, we saw a lot of, things, you know, Kat, obviously, I was there when the world's accident with Sarah had gone down, and that was a very emotional, crazy year. We saw the stuff with Paul Macbeth. Just to start out the year, we saw, you know, your teammate, Jeremy Colling, with one of the nominated top moments of the year, you know, hitting the putt. And I know, Paul, you were somewhat vocal about that and seeing your reaction in the background. Does that feel like that was, you know, already like 10 months ago when that was happening?
You know, that's what the other one that I was going to say besides my ace. I mean, that had to have been for me the most memorable moment to see, you know, Jeremy's one of my best friends, and see him be successful right away. And that putt was incredible. And then to see Macbeth top it with the putt that he made, I mean, you know, just a sports fan and an athlete in general, that was definitely one of my highlights of the whole entire year, just to see, you know, great athletes in our sport going after it to start the year off.
Yeah, I'm on record saying, as far as a single moment, I think that's the top one this year. I mean,
oh yeah, I might have passed out for a second there in the background.
Yeah.
Now we're seeing, you know, we kind of joke with you guys about how much you're playing and off-season conversation, but Paul Macbeth's out working out. I think he posted that video today, and lots of people, you know, Sarah Holcomb was doing her 100 putts for 100 days last year, and all these different people are doing their different things to gear up for next year. Do you guys ever really slow down, or do you guys kind of just, you know, keep your momentum with a short break? It doesn't seem like your off season, so to speak, is nearly as defined as some of our other players.
Well, we just were, like we said, we were in Minnesota, and of course it was cold, so I didn't touch a disc for, I think it was like 12 days.
Nice.
But I did go to the gym, I think like 10 of the 12 days, so.
Okay.
But I need to do something when it's 2 degrees out. I can't sit around all day. But
Paul, do you got anything that you like to do to keep yourself? I said it before you guys joined the show that I know you're very athletic and competitive guy. Is there other things that you find yourself keeping busy with when you're not?
I'm just eating a lot of ice cream and pizza out there.
That's what I would do.
Now you're talking.
No, like you said, I definitely go to the gym, you know, as much as I can, and I work out. I work on my putt. I work in the field. I'd like to think that I'm one of the hardest working players that we have in the game, and that's something that I take pride in. And so, even though my off season is definitely shorter than a lot of people's, I still find a way to get stronger, healthier. We're all trying to catch, you know, Macbeth and Ricky and Will and all those guys, and we're all going to work hard. It's not like we're just going to sit back and watch them work out and blah, 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 blah. It's still a sport. And, seeing Macbeth post stuff, seeing Ricky post stuff, I mean, I might just go get a couple sparkle putters and start sparkle putting at night or something. No, totally kidding. But, no, we're definitely working hard.
Now, you said a moment ago that you're out there working on your putt, and some people might say, which putt are you working on? Because I know you've switched up your style a number of times. You seem to have settled into the Anheuser style release. I think we talked about it sometime earlier in the year, but any major switches, any technique or form or game plan, anything you found so far that you want to specifically address or adjust?
I'm just trying to get a little more consistent as far as switching my putt. I just work on whatever I can, whatever feels good that day. But we'll see. I mean, just whatever I feel like will give me the best chance to win the tournament is what I'm going to do when it comes tournament time. I could practice a putt for 20 hours straight, but then once they say 2 minutes, maybe I'll anheuser putt, heiser putt, I have no idea.
Yeah, whatever feels the best at that exact moment.
Exactly, yeah.
Now, Kat, we're seeing the women's division continue to get more and more competitive. For instance, this year we saw Owen Scoggins at a few more events. She still had a phenomenal, showing at Worlds. That's what she does. She shows up and performs very well there always. But anything else you're seeing on the women's side? Do you feel like we're seeing any influx of new women that are coming out to play, or anyone that you think we should be looking out for?
I would agree that since I started, it was kind of just like maybe Val. I think Val was winning a lot when I first started, and then sometimes maybe Paige would win or whatever. And now it's like at some tournaments, sometimes there's a chance that maybe 10 of the women mm-hmm. have a chance to win instead of like one or two. So. Kind of the same thing. I know that I can't just sit around all winter and not practice and watch Netflix or whatever. I have to go to the gym, go out and putt. I actually been working on a new putt, and so I'm excited about that. And yeah, I think we lost you for a second.
No, that's me. What you're seeing, and this is some insider stuff, but what you're seeing is basically what everybody else is seeing. So sometimes when I'll cut just to the guests, especially if I feel that you're going to be talking about something important or something significant, or I need to turn away and sneeze, then you'll just get your own feedback. So just little things.
Okay. Yeah. No. So like I said, I see it growing, and that's like I said, why I've been working harder, and it's just gonna continue to grow, I think. Obviously, with all the women's tournaments and things like that we have going on. So maybe someday we'll have our own women's tour.
Yeah, and I think that was one of the conversations that was kind of said is, all right, UC's doing this. He's not necessarily focusing on the women. And I heard it loud and clear from a number of people on Facebook. Like, all right, well, then maybe that's our cue. We need to do our own thing to get what we want out of it. Someone had asked as to what would you like to see in the women's division. I don't know if that's generic or not. I'm going to guess you'd like to just see more women.
More competitors.
But anything else that you think you'd like to see when it comes to maybe this is your chance to give a good pro tip for all the TDs out there as to, one thing that you'd really love to see addressed when it comes to hosting women at tournaments?
I was going to gear more to, like, expand more on what I said about the less divisions.
Okay.
I would like to see less divisions offered. Right now, I mean, we could use Women's US for an example. I think there was, I did the research a couple months ago, but I don't know, maybe 10 or more champions crowned, and sure. We had, like, I think it was 70 women, so that seems kind of crazy when you think of it like that.
Do you
so
think
I just like to see less divisions to see more women play together. An example I use with it is, you know, they have two or three people in each division. And so, for example, if one of those women in the smaller divisions has a good round, that person might not even move up. Like, they could have the best round of their life, but because they're only playing with, like, against one or two other people, do you get what I'm saying? So
yeah.
I feel like...
Yeah, well, I know I was going to say, do you feel like maybe something, some sort of modified entry fee? I'm sure some women are scared away thinking, well, I don't want to play in the open field because, you know, so-and-so, I'm never going to compete with them. So maybe have trophy only or, you know, players pack only and not have it necessarily go into the entry fee for certain events. Not, obviously not things like Worlds, but some of the larger women's only events. And then compress the divisions more so that there's more women. Because one of the things you'll hear a lot of people say is you get better by playing with people that are better than you. It'll raise your competition level and you'll learn things. So is that something that you could see happening?
Maybe something like that. I just on numbers alone, don't think there's a reason to have all those divisions. And what I see when I go back and look, because I've been doing research and trying to figure out a way to, you know, get more women. How can we, and not just women, but I'd like to see more competitive women, you know, like more women who want to go out and do their best. And not saying that people don't, but it's just quite different than the men's division, if you will. And so if you look, there'll be, say, like, especially at Women's US, six divisions that only have two or three women in them, and they all shot very similar scores. So there alone is like a 18 person division who could have just all played together.
Or someone says, more ratings based, even.
Exactly. More ratings based. Yes, that would be better, I think.
So it doesn't matter if you're 12 or 72, if you're rated 900.
Get to it.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. I think there's some clever ways to I don't want to say manipulate, but to shift around the players and the people and whatnot to, like you said, basically create more competition, you know, but still have it be in the women's, you know, divisions and atmosphere. I think that's a great idea.
But I do think that 92-year-olds should probably have their own.
Okay.
Johnny. And maybe 12-year-olds too. I'm just
if they're shooting the same, I mean, there's things you can learn. I'm just saying. You know?
No. Well, yeah, that's a fight.
I learned a lot of stuff from a 92-year-old.
I bet you can.
Oh my god. That's an argument I have, whether the person is, say, 16 or 35, if they're the same rated. One might be more consistent, one may throw further, one may be a better putter. I mean, that's how it works in, you know, all divisions. So
sure.
And plus, an argument also is, I see that when more women are signed up, more women continue to sign up.
Yeah.
So I feel like if we had less divisions, it would encourage more women to play together as well.
Okay.
So speaking of that, I'm going to put you on the spot just slightly and ask, what is your favorite, and it's just a favorite, but what's your favorite women's only event that you've been at or been a part of so far?
The Disc Girls Gone Wild in Michigan.
Okay.
Yep. I don't know. Something about it I love.
No, that
it's a common theme. I think that a lot of women will agree with that.
Yeah, and I know here in Wisconsin, the Wisco Disco, Jenny Brandt and the rest of the crew are going to be putting on, I think it's the third or fourth year for the Wisco Disco. I know that's going to be a B or C tier, I believe a C tier, and super exciting because I know they've had a really good draw and have friends over there in Michigan that they've drawn from and everywhere else.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
So lots of great events going on. And then this year's the Women's Global. And I know we kind of just touched on that when I asked Paul specifically about the ESPN weekend and the American Disc Golf Tour Women's Global event. Will that could still no, that couldn't take place in Utah if it's not sanctioned. Will you be in Utah, or are you going to find a women's?
I will be in Utah, and we have talked with the tournament director about seeing. I think we might make it sanctioned for that
the women's
reason,
global
that
yep.
day or that reason.
Perfect.
Or those
maybe
rounds.
Just for the women or something yep. to make sure. They're a part of it, yep.
No, that's perfect. Awesome. Yeah, what a unique experience there too, when we have literally, you know, hundreds of women from all over competing against one another virtually, so to speak.
Right.
Any
And at that to touch back on mm-hmm. at that tournament, the Daisy Chains.
Yep.
Where I normally am playing. The first round they do like the European thing where you play mixed divisions. And then the next round, the first couple of years I played, they did it by score. So, and that was kind of neat because the scorecards were colored and you could see how you placed just by your score and not by your divisions. And so that was kind of neat to see the cards so mixed. There was even like an advanced girl on the lead card. So,
that's a great idea. I think that allows, like you're saying, for everyone to be intermingled, but, you know, see that everyone, can come out and compete on any
especially
given day.
With you know the women exactly. who tend to play with the same women, especially locally, over and over and over. It might get them a little bit more
right. Yep, exactly.
Now I know we spoke of Prodigy and you guys are there. We talked about the people shifting. Any other new players that Prodigy is welcoming, or any Prodigy initiatives that you'd like to talk about, or that you guys have that are in the works, or anything along those lines?
Yeah, I think we did really well in the offseason picking up some new players. I know Kobe Geis, yep. Colin Forehands, DJ Gilbert from Arizona,
yep.
one of my good friends, got picked up. A lot of good people, like you said, the women's amateur world champion
yep,
from
Vanessa.
2014. Vanessa. And, yeah, so we definitely have a lot of good players that have switched over and are really excited, and we're happy to welcome them.
Any teasers that you can give us about whether it's new products, new discs, new anything? I mean, you guys debuted the basket last year. I believe that was last year. You debuted it. Anything else in the works? I know a bag was just a couple of months ago. A new version of your bag was a couple of months ago. Anything else that that you can, you know, let our Smashies know about? All the secrets?
Without, so I don't say too much and get in trouble. I don't want to get fined. No, just kidding. No,
Terry will cover any fines.
We have a lot in the works, and so I think in the next 2 or 3 weeks that stuff will be released, and good. I'm excited about it. So
okay, fair
super
enough.
Excited. Yep.
No,
I think the biggest thing that for last year for me was the A1 coming out.
Okay,
and that definitely filled a big hole into my bag, and so
perfect. Yeah. Now, before we were live, we had a quick test with Kat earlier. Kat, can you share where you guys are at the room, the workspace that you guys are in?
This is the disc golf room, and there's our trophies, some of Will's discs, and then some more trophies, some pictures. Can you guys see? Okay.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Yeah. And yeah, like my old Discraft, what is that, Rookie of the Year? And then if you look up, there's a Buzz signed by Steve and Paul. We stopped out at Applebee's and celebrated my birthday on the way to the Vibram before I won that one year.
Nice.
And they signed a Buzz for me, not sure why.
Birthday Buzz.
That's right.
Trish and Will kissing on a disc.
All right. This is PG here.
Come on.
Okay. There's the dog's kennel, so yeah, that's it.
Awesome.
So what house is this at? If this is in Tennessee, is this a particular person
this
or
is
this?
Yeah, this is Will, Trish, Paul, and I's house that we rent. Well,
okay.
Obviously, you know, Paul and I are road warriors, so we're here very rarely. But yeah, we all rent the house together.
Okay.
And even just over your shoulder, I can see a St. Jude, a disc from last year, which is pretty awesome.
Yep.
That one sticks out. And one of the reason why one of those... any of those St. Jude discs are really special. There was some strict guidelines and restrictions about, you know, that their logo, everything has to be approved, you know, by their corporate and everything else. So I thought that was one of the cool things people maybe don't appreciator of value, just how unique right. that those discs really were. And I'm sure we're going to see some cool initiatives this year for fundraising, but something to keep in mind that you can't just take any logo and throw it on a disc, or you're going to, you're not going to see those all over the place. All right. One of the question that has come in and says that for Kat and Paul, when you guys said the quality and professionalism is what you like where you go to big tournaments, what specifics can you relate to, or what specific things might you be looking for when you talk about a quality event or a really well-run or professional event? Anything that jumps out specifically?
I think one of the themes that I see that's becoming really popular with the bigger tournaments is one course, three rounds, four rounds maybe.
Yeah.
And I think that's more appealing probably to the touring pro, because we don't have a lot of time. Maybe we're traveling from tournament to tournament and we have to practice one course. And then to top it off, it's just easier, I feel like, for maybe spectators, easier for filming, to where you know the course layout, you know the shots, and maybe one round spectators can watch, and you guys film and people at home can watch, and then they kind of get a feel for maybe the next round and stuff. And so that's one thing that I really see that's getting more and more popular, and that I really appreciate in tournaments, is one round really good courses, or one course really good layout.
And speaking of that, it was announced a couple weeks ago about Worlds reducing the number of rounds. I was going to ask if that's an applause, if that should be something. Yeah. So do you like that? Do you think it should be a standard 4-round event like all of our other events, or do you think it should be? What's your opinion? What's your thoughts?
No, I think it should be 4 rounds, one course, in my opinion. And like, when I'll never forget, Terry asked me, you know, how do you feel? And I was like, oh my gosh, I was really just so glad it was over. Like, to go to bed every night. What is it? 6 nights or?
Yeah.
With the lead. I mean, there was a night he came home and he didn't have the lead, and he goes, haha, at least I get some sleep tonight. Like.
It's an intense, it's grueling. It's, you know, they say marathon. And,
I just think it'll be better overall. I mean, sometimes we practice a course and we only play it one round, and it's an hour and a half away from where we're. It just becomes like, I don't know how to explain it.
Well, it's draining.
It'll be better.
It's definitely draining mentally and physically. And I'm with you as far as reducing the number of courses. I think that's very important. I think I'm gonna miss like the final nine. If it's true they go away from a final nine, that there's a certain kind of drama that you get usually in a final nine like that. And without that, it seems so strange to think we're focusing on a lead card at the World Championships and someone from the second card jumps up and wins.
Yeah,
and in a 4-round tournament, you could get that.
I think with that though. You also have to think, when you're doing that, if the person in fourth is a stroke or two behind, they have nothing to lose. So it takes away from golf, in my opinion.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's true.
And I think from now on, in my opinion, and I think Paul will agree with me, I think Final Nine should be for charity or skins or something, where we can just throw some crazy shots and have fun, interact with the crowd more than be like, oh my gosh, I played 7 rounds, now I gotta play 9 more and hope that this safari course doesn't lose me the tournament or something, you know?
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of the safari final nines, but I see your point definitely with those people that are in fourth place, not, you know, they've got nothing to lose. They can make some crazy shots and stuff. So.
Yeah,
I'm definitely excited for it also. It's weird getting away from the tradition, and I think maybe a lot of old school players are kind of like, what? No, that's like the thing, play 1,000 rounds, final nine, all that stuff. But I think with the sport growing and the direction that it's going, I think that has to happen, and it did happen, and I'm excited about it.
I'd love to see 5 rounds and then cut down to like just 48 people or something after the fourth round. Have the fifth round, just whoever's cashing, you get to play another round. Everybody else, watch.
Yeah,
and then one round that everybody counts for.
I mean, that
something
like
that.
And I feel like that's one of the reasons why we had a final nine and everything is for the people in the tournament to watch.
Yeah.
And that eventually is going to be another thing that we have to get away from. Like, after I'm done playing the World Championships, I don't think I'm going to want to watch my competitors play, you know?
Yeah. No, I mean, if you're not in it, I can totally understand. Or if you just barely miss it, it's not, right. You know, you kind of feel like you should be there for a teammate or something, but you may not want to be, honestly. You're like, okay, way to go, Germ. I'm going to hang out here by the car. And
So I think with the way the sport's growing and everything, eventually it'll be a good thing, because then you'll just have spectators watching instead of players, which is really what we need to be going after anyway. And that's a really cool thing I feel like that UC's hitting on, is the media part and making sure that it's spectator friendly and a lot of that.
Yeah, I think there's going to be some kind of happy medium, a compromise somewhere between the 6 or 7 rounds plus finals, and then now they've announced it is going to be 4. I think we're going to find it ultimately fall somewhere in between the two.
You think so?
I think. I'm not sure that everything's set in stone, but like you're saying, the 4 rounds plus maybe a fifth, you know, that's really a semis or, you know.
Yeah, it's a final.
A reduced field.
I'm also excited because I've been known to maybe have the lead after the 4.
Yeah, we
tradition going.
Yeah, we discussed that a couple weeks ago with Dan on who would have taken home the championships after 4 rounds.
Yep.
And your name, believe it, did come up.
I remember talking to you back in Indiana at that World Championships. That was very early in my blogging career. You and I were talking.
We were babies back then. Yeah, that was early in my career, too.
Back in the day.
Yeah. When you're still loving the original intro music. Shout out, Bobby Brown. Thank you. Cool Daddy Slick Breeze. And then, you know, a few years later, you find yourself in a position as well over at Portland, and just what an intense week it is really for everybody. So it'll be interesting to see how things unfold and where things shift. You know, we saw Macbeth this year, you know, obviously wasn't in the lead and then kind of turned it on for a few rounds and then, you know, closed it out that way. But
right. It's definitely going to shake some things up. It's going to be harder for people like Macbeth to win after 4 rounds, and that's just pure logic. I mean, obviously over a long period of rounds, he's proven that right now he's the best player, but after 4 rounds, I mean, it's just going to give a lot of people just that, you know, that much room or whatever.
Yeah, it's going to be who gets high.
Exactly.
And I know he was a former teammate and all, but real quick, Alex Geisinger, is he one that could maybe hang with a Simon in terms of a distance competition, or do you guys have anyone else that we didn't discuss that if there was a distance competition tomorrow out in Arizona, who might be some front runners?
Yeah, you know, I've been working on my 360 and no, absolutely not. But, no, Alex has.
Is that a putt? That your new 360 putt? I'm not sure.
Oh man, no, Alex has definitely raw power. One of the most talented people throwing the disc that you'll see out there as far as distance wise and just being a golfer. And you know, good luck to him and his new sponsorship. Wish nothing but the best for him. And as far as other people that I know that throw far, I mean, Simon, you know, the regular guy, Simon, David Wiggins, Alex Geisinger, I think those are your main guys.
Okay. That's what I was looking to confirm, is if you feel like those are the three that
Big Germ, if he started training maybe a little harder.
Okay, I was going to ask who works harder on the off season, you or Big Germ, but I think we know the answer.
Big Germ.
Big Germ. All right, we'll wrap things up. Is there anything you guys would like to share? You got an open floor, anything you want to discuss, ask, tell us, say to anyone out there?
No, I mean, we're just really excited for the 2016. You guys have all the questions right there with people typing in.
Yeah.
That was one of my favorite things. I think it was last year, the week before, when Macbeth was doing his interview, is looking at all the comments and kind of commenting and stuff. And thank you guys.
For having us.
Yeah, for having us and for doing this every week, right?
Yeah,
every week, 9 p.m. Central.
Every week, yeah. I've been enjoying it, so thank you guys for your time.
All right. Well, Kat, Paul, we wish you guys the best of luck. Like I said, you're not done with me. I'll see you guys in like 9 or 10 days. I'll be looking forward to getting some more action. And hopefully, last time I was at a tournament you were at, both of you, you both walked away champions. So.
Nice. Well, we'll probably be playing in the same division, so let's see.
So one of you two better win. All right. All right.
It's getting hot lately.
I would love more than anything to record the tournament. That'll be their doing next weekend. Record the tournament that Kat takes down the other top pros that are there.
I want it to go.
Yeah.
Kat, Pete, then Paul.
Hey-o.
You know, I have zero complaints about that.
Okay. I know.
And then Felberg.
I'm not going to lay down that easy, I don't think.
Felberg in like fifth or sixth.
Oh, geez,
no? Is that what you're saying? I mean, you just named the top three.
I named top three. I'm done with that.
All right, I'm just saying.
Not going to go any further. Okay. I had him the last tournament we played together going into the second round, but
she
then.
Did, yeah.
I would
turn it up a little bit, maybe.
I'm telling you, I would love to be the guy. I love supporting women's disc golf as much as I can. I would love to be the guy that was there filming this epic battle and this history making event. It would be awesome. I'd love to do it. So, I'm rooting for you, Kat.
Awesome. Well, we'll see you soon.
All right, guys, travel safely to the other side of the country. I'll see you guys in about 9 or 10 days. And as always, thanks so much for joining us.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
All right,
it was fun. It was fun, guys. Safe travels.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you, everybody, for watching.
All right, and there we have it. Of course, Kat and Paul joining us here tonight. Road Warriors, they're always having a good time out on the tour. they pick up kids every once in a while in Keylander, Richard Keylander.
Now, when I said he's a big kid, I mean, that's physically and and the way he acts. Like yes, that guy is so much fun.
He does he does have a very good time and enjoys himself. Just for the record, I have gone out to Ricky Wysocki's Facebook page and told him that we were talking about him earlier, and that if he's going to, in fact, wants to give a movie review, we'll take him live on the air here tonight. Maybe that'll be in the regular show or the after show. But
Dion Arlen thinks that he could possibly break the world record with a little bit of practice and the right wind. He's one of those guys that's out there. I know we've talked about him before.
You know what his nickname is?
Dion the Whip.
That's right.
So
make him nay-nay. Make him whip.
Whip nay-nay-nay-nay, something like that.
I
think
know.
That's how he got the nickname. He was doing the whip and nay-nay at one point.
Like that. If only that was...
That would be true.
10 years ago.
Yeah.
Because I think the nickname... Yeah.
Yeah. I think Dion just needs a new video. It's something that's going to go viral.
There it is. thank you guys for joining us. We're going to move into a giveaway.
Another giveaway.
Like we said, our show tonight brought in part to you by a number of sponsors that have stepped up, and we're super appreciative of everyone that's doing it. Next week, we're going to have Val Jenkins. She's going to stop in. She's going to also give us some semi-regular updates. We just talked about the Women's Global event. And she is chairing that and is in charge of so many different things. But she's going to kind of give us some updates regarding the Women's Global event as that moves closer and closer in May. So every few weeks or so, I think she's going to do that for us. But so what do we gave away a couple of Discraft discs before. Well, Dynamic Discs is another amazing sponsor here on the podcast. They just celebrated Disc Golf Answer Man podcast number 100.
A century.
We got to catch them.
We will. We do more podcasts during the season when we go places, and we'll do three in a weekend. So it might take us another 2 years, but
we'll catch up to them.
We'll catch them. And then we'll have them on. When we catch them and we're at the same number, we'll have them on.
Oh, yeah. That'll
be a good crossover.
Inception, is that the?
No, crossover.
Oh, crossover. Okay. All right. So Bobby Brown, Cool Daddy Slick Breeze, who does all of the amazing video work and social media work over there at Dynamic Discs, he is going to send out a couple discs. We're going to do this for two discs. He's going to have to pick them because I'm not sure where we last left that. But he's going to send out two discs. And the question will be, if everyone's ready,
the first answer.
Here's the question, and we're gonna go ahead and we'll make it easy, and we will make it the first answer, the first correct answer. So, coming straight from Bobby Brown, Cool Daddy Slick Breeze.
Two Dynamic Discs. We're not sure which molds, but
you'll love them.
You'll love them.
Give us the month and year the first Disc Golf Answer Man podcast episode was in. The month and year the first Disc Golf Answer Man podcast and episode. I'm going to give you a clue. They started way before us. Mm-hmm. Almost a year and a half before us. So carry the one. Yeah, that makes sense why they have that many more than us. So if you're listening live, we appreciate it. And we see a couple answers. We've got June 2013, February 2014, March, April 2013, June 2011, July 2013 is the correct answer.
All right. So we saw the correct answer. We're going to scroll up. We're going to see.
I thought it was somebody Mac is what I thought I saw, but go ahead and scroll up.
There it is. Mike Mac.
Mike Mac. Congratulations, buddy. Please send me, if you happen to be friends with Cool Daddy Slick Breeze, you can send him a message directly, yep. Or you can send it to me, and I will pass it on. I believe I have one or two others to pass on, but send it over to me, Mike Mack, here on the board.
July 2013?
July 2013.
God, they're old.
Yeah. They're old and stuff. So congratulations, Mike Mack. As he said, July 2013. I just needed the month and year. I don't know if it was really July 4th or not, but the month and year is correct in July of 2013, thanks to Dynamic Disc and Cool Daddy Slick Breeze. Sweet. All right, let's move into a couple other things I've got. Again, I know I gave you a little bit of a hint or a clue earlier, but there's going to be at least one or two more statistics-driven questions, somewhat statistical-driven.
Okay.
I did some mad research.
Wow.
Yeah, because that's what I do. Anyway, I do want to make a quick plug and let everyone know that the Disc Golf Guy video blog was literally updated minutes before the show. We've got yet another section of the Spikeheiser Tour Finale Championships. We've been rolling that out slowly but surely, so everybody's got a little bit of fresh content every few days or so. Huge shout out to my pal Tony, who's been helping with some of the editing and reducing my workload a little bit. So I appreciate it, Tony. I couldn't do it without you. I really appreciate it, buddy. So that's released, and then look for the very final nine in the next day or two or three days. The final nine from that in the conclusion of that tournament. Like I said, I did speak with Dave Felberg a couple of times in the last couple of days, and I have nailed it down that I will be going to the Maricopa Open. I'll be excited to go out there and cover that event. Now, Dave, I believe, is actually the guy on record as the TD.
Dave.
So I'm going to get in his face, ask him all sorts of silly tournament.
Former top pro, Dave Felberg, right?
Yes, and Dave Felberg, who told us a few years ago that he was going to be retiring from golf and doing other stuff.
Well, maybe this is a start. He's starting to do tournament directing, and yeah, he's...
So looking forward to it, and we may or may not have a little catch-up session at some point with Dave and see what he's got going on. But looking forward to going out to the tournament and bringing you some coverage. That's going to get turned around relatively quickly because there's going to be a lot more tournaments coming up very soon. So
we're going to get busy.
Busy, yeah. You're going to get busy. I'm going to get busier.
I didn't say that. I don't deny that.
All right, we saw Steve Mills on the board tonight. Steve, I know you're good friends with Cat and Paul. Well, thanks for tuning in and checking out some of the action. Wow, we haven't even gone on that long here tonight. Pretty impressive.
Not bad.
I will say this. Seems like there were a few people perturbed that they didn't have any they didn't have a podcast
last week
during their long drives for Christmas and other places they had to go.
True.
There were some people or coming back from or whatever.
Been coming back from.
Yeah, from Christmas or a really long drive out.
Yeah, which we can sometimes cover. So
we do appreciate it. Of course, our show is going to continue to evolve. I'm really excited about, like I said, we really have a direction for at least the next two or three weeks. We're always willing to take guests. We're always willing to look for the latest and greatest stories and things that are going on. But we definitely have some specific directions for the next few weeks, for sure, for people to make sure that you're tuned in as I'm trying to get caught up here on everything else that's going on the board. Anything else going on your end?
No.
Let's talk about the talk of the talk that's not disc golf at the moment.
What? Oh, we get after show for that.
Oh, okay. Well, we could talk about that in the after show.
We'll talk about this is Smashbox.
Like it matters.
We're going to talk about disc golf on the Smashbox.
Let's ask this. How many people turn off the podcast and then say, well, no, they're not talking about disc golf. I'm going to go listen to the after show instead.
Maybe.
Yeah, I don't think very many people
I like a delineation.
Okay.
Where we can then just hang loose.
We
so,
have to be
so
on
you,
task.
You have some notes. You have
okay. So things. here's what we're gonna do. We've got Daredevil Discs. As we said, we're talking with Ricky Singleton next weekend. He is your U.S. distributor and the main man in charge here in the U.S. So he's gonna be joining us to tell us everything about that is Daredevil Discs next week. He told me to just go ahead and run a little contest of sorts or do whatever I want, and we would give away some discs. So. Did you nail down some discs that we were talking about giving away here?
Yeah, I went to their website, which is daredevildiscs.com.
Clever.
Just as it sounds.
Clever.
Or if you're not very good at reading, you could say it was daredevildiscs.com, but either one
sure,
works.
Sure.
And we're just kind of scrolling through. They've got a couple. Looks like they're going after kind of an animal theme. I was going to say extinct animals, but they got buffalo on there, so.
Too soon,
buffalo. But yeah, speaking of the buffalo, I think that's the one that we're going to look at giving some away of. We're going to give a buffalo at least how many? One,
two. Let's give two, away two.
Two buffalos. It's a more beginner-friendly overstable wind driver offered in weights in the mid-160s, between 163 and 167. So I think it would be it's good to give away to some of our smashies.
All right, smashies. So here's an easy one for you, relatively easy. I'm going to ask you which, and this is going to go to the first person to answer correctly. So here we go. What round currently has the most views in our 2015 Smashbox season? This is on YouTube. Which round currently, and it's
so you have to answer the tournament and the round.
Right? Sure. Yeah. Yeah. What round? Yes. Tournament and round has the most views of stuff we showed in 2015.
I don't even know the answer to that. I'm fairly certain I know which tournament it is, and so I would kind of guess I know which round it is.
World's final round would be tough because we did not broadcast that, and I think I just saw the first right answer scrolling up, and there were some people that were close by saying the Memorial. Go back up and make sure there was no one else with Memorial final round. So we had Memorial. We had World's final round. I was looking for Memorial final round, and that was Memorial 4. There you go. Michael Gibney. Michael, you are our winner. We're gonna have to limit how many times people can win here. Michael, you may have won before. Maybe not. I don't know. But
eventually. That means we'll start keeping track.
Yeah, eventually. So Michael Gibney had the correct answer. Currently, right now, our Memorial round number 4 has 50,216 views. That was at the beginning of the podcast. It didn't change drastically enough since we started the podcast, so I know that's the right answer.
I'm a little surprised, actually. I thought it was... I was wrong. I was going to go with the Maple Hill Open final round. But
I don't have that off the top of my head, but I don't believe I should double check. No, that was second... Yeah. Most
yeah, that was the second round. Most. Yeah, I'm looking at the stats right now, right? So, yeah, I was wrong then. So,
well,
I would not have won.
No, you are not a winner. So, there you have it. I've got another really interesting stat. Maybe I'll just throw it out as a stat for, I don't know, maybe log it somewhere in your head so that some other day it could be referenced in some capacity. But here's an interesting stat for you that in 2015, our second year of being live on Smashbox, and obviously that last year was the majority of the year that we did our live podcast, which only make up for a small number overall of our total viewer hours and minutes and such. But for our entire 2015 year, I'd love somebody to take a guess as to either how many minutes or hours. What would be more interesting? I've got both because I can, you know, multiply and divide by 60. I take a guess as to roughly how many minutes.
Oh.
Minutes or hours. You give me either answer, but just make sure you know.
Oh, I think we did like a total minutes a couple months ago. A month or two ago. Yeah, we did like total guess like the, within.
Oh, maybe we did.
Total minutes, yeah.
Really?
I think we may have.
I don't remember. It's been a lot. For our 2015 season. So a lot of people talk about the various...
This isn't a giveaway, is
it? No, it's no giveaway. It's just before I was going to draw it out a little bit. I think it's astonishing, honestly, because you can talk about views, and views are great, and we just said 50,000 for the memorial. Yeah. You know, I know an edited round could easily get 50,000, blah, blah, blah. But when you're talking about the duration of Smashbox, what this actually does is it measures the time watched.
Correct, because an edited round that you may do for an event, you know, a final, we'll say a front nine, 20 minutes, 22 minutes, whatever it may be. But with the Smashbox stuff we do are full rounds. So, you know, you'll get people spotting in and out, bouncing here and there, watching some now, some later, fast-forwarding. But this, it keeps track of the number of minutes watched.
Yeah,
so.
Minutes watched that we served up, I believe, for free.
Yeah.
At no point did anyone pay for, did any viewers pay for these. All right, we had some amazing sponsors throughout
awesome
the year.
Awesome sponsors.
All across the board, a lot of different disc manufacturers, a lot of different groups and people that we worked with in 2015. But I'm going to go ahead and say it, that this is the number of minutes viewed that Smashbox TV served up in 2015 to you guys. 13,617,000 minutes.
Nice.
And that comes out to, I think when you put it in, your minutes are great, whatever. I think when you put it into hours, we served up and provided, or had people watch, I guess it depends how you look at it, 226,950 hours.
Wow.
That were viewed on our page this year. So 200, we'll call it 227,000 hours were watched on Smashbox this year. I'm sorry. I'm sorry you had to listen to me for so long and look at me for part of that, but 226,950 hours on Smashbox TV this year. So that's hope you awesome. Guys enjoyed it. It was a pretty amazing season for sure. That includes after shows. That includes everything. I think out of 226,000 hours, how many of those are just after show hours?
Three quarters.
It definitely was an amazing year. I'm going to continue to compile some stats. I know I'm working on some Disc Golf Guy video blog stats. It's just really amazing when you sit back and you can look at, you know, January 1st all the way through December 31st.
Yep,
and
our first full year.
Correct.
From start to finish of broadcast.
And I think one thing that I started to do, and I'm sorry I didn't get completely finished, and maybe I'll have the stats by after show, but just the amount of events we covered this year. Can you remember them all off the top of your head? Well, we could find them in a matter of seconds too, but can you remember all the live events that we covered this year?
Memorial.
Yep.
Maple Hill.
Correct.
GBO.
Glassblown, yep.
Ledgestone.
Yes.
USDGC.
Not on our page, but yes.
But we covered it.
Right, yep.
We covered it. I know there's more. There's more. I know there's more than five.
We covered a World Championships.
Oh, yeah. Well, the Birdie Bash we did.
There you go. The Birdie Bash World Championships.
We covered... Well, no, we didn't do live. Never mind. I was going to say AmWorld. You and I went there, did some filming afterwards. Yep. We didn't cover live. Is there anything else live that I missed?
No, I think we caught all the live ones, I think you just said. So,
okay.
In order, we covered the Memorial to start the year, which is where we debuted our two-camera coverage,
yep.
Which seemed to go relatively well throughout the year. It was a big upgrade from 2014's action. We were obviously then at the Glassblown Open, and we thank Dynamic Discs and crew for welcoming us there. We were covering the Chase card, which is also where we caught the ace for Billy Engel,
yeah.
Which made it onto SportsCenter.
And Billy Engel actually just announced that he's on Team Innova.
Which I thought he already was, but...
I don't know.
Maybe he wasn't. Maybe. Either way, congrats.
Congrats to Billy.
And then we covered the Maple Hill Open, including the Skins match that happened beforehand.
Yeah.
So the Maple Hill Open this year. We covered the Vibram Birdie Bash World Championships, thanks to Steve Dodge and Vibram over in Michigan. The Ledgestone, and then as you said, the USDGC. So that plus 58 podcasts.
Yeah.
So
did you even, in all those minutes, did you even count the USDGC?
No. Actually, I did not because... I didn't. They weren't on our.
Yeah. So we can't check out those analytics.
Yeah, we'd have to go hunt them down.
We could we could ask Spin, and I'm sure they'd let us know. But
yeah, so cool. Let's
very
count
cool.
Real quickly again. That was Memorial, Glassblown, Maple Hill, Birdie Bash Championships, Ledgestone, And then we'll USDGC. So that's six events we were live at this year. And then in our opening year, we were technically live, getting our feet wet at Bowling Green AMs, the Rumble, Minnesota AM Champ, Minnesota AM Worlds, Vibram Open last year, the AM Worlds. I thought I already said. Oh, I said that one. Sorry. We did the battle at Blue Lake, which was huge. We did Sylmar Open. We did Mad City Open. And we did San Diego Open. Holy cow.
Yeah.
So 2014, we did technically eight live tournaments. 2015, we did seven of them. So pretty crazy. Anyway, little reflection. It's been a good couple of years, and we look forward to providing many, many more.
Many more.
And thank you, first and foremost, again, to our viewers. And then secondly, to our sponsors. All possible because of our sponsors.
That's right.
And we've had a lot of different sponsors that have jumped on board and have supported us in a lot of different ways. And we continue to encourage them to jump on board and support and sponsor what we're doing, because we're just trying to make things as big and as good as we possibly can. All right. So we're going to close out. This is our first podcast here of 2016. How many do you think, knowing we did 58 last year?
I'm going to guess we do right around there as well this year.
I think we're going to do more.
You think so?
Okay. I think it's going to be closer to 70.
Wow.
When it's all said and done.
Yeah, never mind. I was not thinking of all of the other ones that we have planned. You're right. Probably closer to 70 podcasts this year.
Yeesh. Sorry. Pre-apologize.
Sorry,
not sorry. Something like that. Mill Dog, we love you, pal. We're sorry you missed it. You'll be able to rewind and go back and see the Cat and Paul interview. That should be available literally. Well, actually, it takes a little bit. You might be able to rewind on your browser right now, but otherwise it'll start to archive tonight yet, and you'll be able to see it, all thanks to our pals over at YouTube and the Googles and the YouTubes. So, Mill Dog, I was surprised to not see you out there earlier, but good to see you on the board now, buddy. All right, so for Johnny V and myself, for Dynamite, Dana Vici, who joined us earlier, of course, for Kat and Paul, our road warriors that are always on the road playing great golf and great ambassadors, great people. We're so glad to have them. Thank you guys very much for joining us. I also like to thank our sponsors that stepped up and were part of us and our broadcast tonight. Daredevil Disc, Discraft, and Dynamic Disc, and any other company that starts with a D. We appreciate all of them. You guys have been awesome to us. Stick around. We're going to have an after show. Johnny wants to get all crazy, he says. Anything goes.
Just saying, it's been 2 weeks.
Anything goes in the after show. So this has been podcast number 68. I'm Terry Miller, the Disc Golf Guy, and for Johnny V, we'll check you guys next week or in the after show when you step inside the Smashbox.
Boo.
Huh? What?
Boo? Scared him. Went away and came back.
All right. We'll make it official. Welcome, everyone. This is Podcast 68's after show.
First after show of 2016.
Oh, so many firsts. So many.
Yeah.
So many good new year beginnings.
There's going to be a lot of these. There's going to be. When we first started doing the podcast, I kind of thought an after show would be, you know, once a month, once every, you know, maybe 6 weeks when we had something to talk about. But it really, yeah, we just do them. Keep doing them.
Well, we have lots of different things that are going on that may be off the grid in terms of disc golf. So it gets a little bit looser. We do a little bit more interacting with you, especially obviously if you're tuned in live on our YouTube page.
If you have any questions, feel free. Anything, you know, not preferably disc golf related, but not necessarily.
Mm-hmm,
we will. This is where we answer your questions as honestly as we can.
No, we're not. You can make that promise.
I will answer the questions as honestly as I can.
I can make no promises at all.
All right. So, yeah. So
you're just saying.
All right. So, Making a Murderer. You have not watched.
I have not watched.
I have not watched.
I'm a Netflixer, but
agreed. Same here.
Have
but
not
the,
watched it.
It is the talk of the world right
it's
now.
It's crazy.
I was informed of it a few weeks ago, and I was kind of like, yeah, I'll get to it. It's a documentary on Netflix. I like watching them. It's about a local case, just about an hour and a half north of us.
Mm-hmm.
But we grew up about 40 minutes from there.
Yeah, west of there.
West of there. So it was big news when we were growing up for a while. So I think there were two cases particularly I remember growing up. Mm-hmm. There was that one and the Lori Deppe's case.
Yep. So okay.
Both of those unfortunately involved missing women. But the Making a Murderer one is just catching fire. Everybody's making jokes about it, especially with the Pro Tour coming to Manitowoc this year.
Yeah.
it's almost like Steve Dodge went ahead and, you know, got some bad pre-advertising.
I called that out. Somebody said something regarding the thing, and I think I said it was a marketing ploy, really, on Steve Dodge's behalf. We got Kevin McCoy out on the board telling us not to watch Interstellar, worst movie ever since Tron. That's a pretty bold...
Then I'm flat out not going to ever pay attention to Kevin's movie picks. He's not... Kevin, you're not going to get your own movie pick because I don't mind Tron. And I've...
What did you think of Interstellar?
I haven't seen it yet, but I've heard decent things about it.
It was really slow.
Yeah, I want to watch... Honestly, it sounds crazy. I want to watch... I'm going to wait for my family to leave. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to go for the trifecta of movies. I'm going to go with Interstellar, Gravity, The Martian.
Ah, okay.
Because I haven't seen...
Any of them?
Any of them. I was going to say either, but no, I haven't seen any of them, and I want to kind of get my whole space fix. So, and The Martian is a great book, which I recommended a year ago before it was made a movie. Ugh, go back and look. I was there.
Yeah.
I haven't seen Neutron. I only saw Ultron. So,
some conversation. Did you guys see the Dynamic Disc new H2O bag with a built-in camel pack? Yeah, Dynamic Disc is... been active on the social medias, the Twitters, the Facebooks, the Periscopes, talking about there's three bags. I know they're bringing the Commander back with, I think, a slight redesign or a slightly different look to it, and then they're working on two other bags. So they're going to have three bags that I want to say are sometime in first quarter, so you're going to see those. I'm trying to think of some other bags that I've seen come out recently. I know there's other ones out there. They're continuing to evolve, and that market continues to get more and more competitive, for sure. Interstellar was very good, Scott says.
A lot of people are saying that. and I have no interest. Kevin McCoy in seeing Revenant, as good as it might be. I think it's Leonardo DiCaprio getting get attacked by a bear. That's pretty much what I've heard and seen, so...
That's what it looks like on his face.
But yeah, built-in camelback, it's been done before, yes.
Sure.
But it's there's not a lot of them out there. And with Dynamic Disc putting one out, it'll be interesting to see if that takes off.
One of the questions, Serge, hi, welcome to the show. Glad to have you from all the way down at UW Parkside area. He says he missed the beginning of the podcast. Who are the touring players that switched sponsors? There was a handful of them that we kind of talked about. A lot of them have been seen on the Facebooks, but Drew Gibson has yet to announce exactly where he's going. He'll do that in 2 weeks from tonight here on the show. James Proctor has recently moved away from Prodigy. Matt Dollar has moved away from Innova. And Gary Patton. Now, I believe Gary has gone to... I know he was with, he was doing some stuff with Steve Dodge and Vibram, and I know. Yep. I saw it on the Facebook. Unfortunately, I just don't recall.
Did he go to Prodigy as well?
I feel like he did.
Okay. We didn't mention it. We just have a list of things. And then Kobe Geis and Colin Forehand.
Yes.
To Prodigy. So those are the players that we know of.
And our good friend Matt Seary, talking about bags and whatnot earlier, Matt Seary had made the announcement. Of course, Matt running the Nick Hyde Memorial on separate weekends, Pro and Am weekends. He says he'd like to officially welcome Bradley Williams, Kevin McCoy, and Gary Patton to the team. So there you go. Okay. That's where some sponsorships come into play, to be on the Bomb Squad over at heiserbomb.com. So Matt Seary making a little bit bigger splash for his team. Some Discrafts. I'm staying.
Dion says he's staying with Discraft, assuming that they will have him back for next year.
Well, so. Dion, congratulations. I know you just welcomed a very, very tiny little one into the world a few days ago, maybe a week or two ago at most. But congratulations to you and your family, pal. I'm not sure, Deanne, if you're normally logged in.
No, I think he said this was his first time.
First time
caller, long time listener. Enjoyed the show. Great topic.
Or no time listener.
Yeah.
But great to have you, Deanne. Appreciate it.
Did our families get discs for Christmas? No, I got zero things disc golf related for Christmas. How about you?
Closest thing that I got that's related, that's not, but it is, would be some, I guess, some disposable hand warmers, which everybody can use any given time.
Yeah.
But I also, one of the things that I asked for and received was a rechargeable hand warmer, one you plug in with a USB.
Mm, yeah. I had one at one point a long time ago. It burnt out real fast. Hopefully yours is good.
Yeah, it plugs in with a USB, and then you unplug it, you turn it on, and it warms up. It's funny because it's almost identically sized to one of my Samsung Galaxy S5 batteries. It literally looks like a Samsung battery with a USB port in it.
Okay. But it seems like a really good way to start a fire.
Not as good as the hoverboard.
I know, as good as the hoverboards. I knew that was coming.
So... William Buckley says he's a Smashbox virgin.
Welcome, William.
Thank you to be here. Brody says he's proud to be sponsored by his parents.
I think a lot of golfers are.
I think they are, yep. Kevin McCoy says he was with Justin Jernigan, Nate Heinold. Yes, down at the IDGC, I believe, or at least in the Augusta area. I know that I reached out to Nate a few days ago, and then I had checked into the Facebook, and he was down south enjoying some decent weather down there. So
yeah.
having some fun and checking out the International Disc Golf Center. Skyline Classic with the date this year. Yes, I've been working on one of the challenges here in Wisconsin and the Midwest is just finding dates for all the different tournaments that are taking place or that people want to run. And It was challenging, and my schedule is obviously filling up in a different capacity that I'm out on the road and doing a lot of things away from Wisconsin these days. So I was up pretty late. I was up till after 3:30 last night, really working on our schedule for like the ninth time, only to wake up 4 hours later after posting it and everybody like, no, this date's wrong, or I need to make this adjustment or make that adjustment. So stay tuned if you're in Wisconsin. Oh, there's
yeah, William Buckley. I was gonna say William Buckley didn't sound like he's been on quite a bit. He was calling Dion that. So
oh no, I didn't think he was talking about a first time on the show. I just thought he was proclaiming himself as a virgin.
Oh
that's what
sorry,
I
sorry William.
I was yeah. like good for you, I guess. Yeah. John Allport says he got himself an Innova Skillshot basket for Christmas. That's pretty awesome.
That is a great gift.
Yep.
Get yourself some putting in.
Questions about new thoughts on MVP baskets. I got to say, I have not seen one. I've told MVP if they would like me to review one, they're more than welcome for them to send me one. I'd be interested in reviewing them and doing a video blog of sorts on them. Disc Golf Wood.
I think that's supposed to be Disc Golf World is trying to sell its business. Because someone asked about the Ice Bowl and Rick Rothstein and whether we have any insider info on that. Because someone's thinking about running an Ice Bowl. I don't know much about Rick's a long time golfer, you know, ancient times. And yeah, there was the Milwaukee doesn't do an Ice Bowl. We do what we call the Big Freeze. We do a charity. There's some charity event to it.
No, not really anymore.
I say on and off. Right now it's off. It's more of just a big event. But the Ice Bowl has been doing some really good charity drives in the past, the actual Ice Bowl. So I don't know much about any behind the scenes stuff with Rick.
Yeah, I know that he's trying to sell Disc Golf World, which you know, I believe includes a storefront, a ton of discs and everything else in Kansas City. I also saw that I believe it was Patrick Johnson out of Illinois was attempting to sell his disc golf business if somebody wanted to take it over.
Really?
Aces and Chains, I believe it is.
Okay.
I know he had that up for possibly for sale as well. Terry, if you want a
Quailo to replace that heavy metal ring you're wearing.
Oh, you can hook us up. Oh, very cool. I appreciate it. it's not that heavy. It's the ball and chain that I carry. Hey, oh, no.
Oh, jeez.
No. It's really not that heavy. And if I did more, I don't want to say, I guess if I flat out said, if I did more athletically strenuous stuff, I could see the advantage to that.
Yeah.
Those are interesting, though. I have wanted to see one of those. You're familiar with those rings? Yeah. I would be interested to see one of those. Those are it's a unique idea. My friend Kelly and Lenny. Kelly's been working out hard over in the Quad Cities, and she was just promoting her ring She's doing all sorts of weightlifting and yeah. training and everything. And she was saying how she loved her ring. So certainly something to look into.
Now, Disc Golf World with Rick Rothstein mm-hmm. used to have a magazine.
Yep. Which was at one point called Disc Golf World News.
Yep.
And then it was...
Because what we're doing now, it's not that's not Rick.
The Disc Golfer.
The Disc Golfer.
I think he has some input on it.
He has some input.
Maybe.
Like an editor.
Of some sort.
Because, and I've said this for years and years, and I know it's a lot of effort and work, all those old issues should be digitized. I know we've got the Disc Golfer back, I believe, as far as it goes, but nothing past that, my understanding is. So Kevin McCoy, I know you're out there. Get on that. Start scanning pages.
Yeah.
You probably have all those back issues.
Yep.
I think it'd be kind of cool to have all of that old, all those old articles and pictures just available on an iPad or a website that I can go through and I can just pull a random, you know, July of 1992
mm-hmm.
and start scrolling through it for whatever reason. So that's something I'd love to see. I've screamed it from the top of the lung, from my top of my lungs for many years. Since more or less tablets have been a thing, I'd love to see those old issues digitized. And I don't know if it'll ever happen, but...
It would be neat.
It would be great.
Just a few minutes ago, I saw Jared Neal said that he says he is continuing his second year, full year, with Dynamic Disc as a sponsor. So congratulations, Jared, making his announcement. Like we said, we're not picky. We'll take anyone's good info regarding sponsorships, people shifting yeah. around. We think it's awesome. Obviously, some of the disc golf companies support us much more than others, but we'll still give a shout out to anyone that is out there and has garnered a sponsorship of sorts. I think
yeah.
it's awesome to see.
It's very cool.
Let's take a look. See,
I want to get sponsored. I'll give you credit. You kept a straight face longer than I thought you would.
Well, because I was trying to think of where to go with it. Is really what it was.
I know. Because
I didn't want to go to who would you want to be sponsored by. That's
no, I don't care. Manitowoc Police Department.
Joe says he's looking for a Terry Miller sponsorship. Those are far and few between because Terry Miller doesn't have.
His wife is looking for that too.
Hey. Yeah. did I see your email from a few days ago? I did. I apologize. Country Disc Golf, he very graciously reached out. I think he had some questions for me. He may have then even followed up with questions for the both of us. I don't recall, but I apologize. It was actually something I wanted to get done, and it's just a matter of sitting down and answering the questions for your website. I apologize. I can get to that sooner than later now.
Do you have any? We didn't do any picks during the broadcast. Do you have any picks? Have you done or seen anything recently?
I'd call it a pick, I guess. I thought it was interesting. It was. It's recent enough since the last broadcast. My pick would be a movie. I don't know if it was really a documentary. It was kind of documentary style, but it was whatever. I watched The Summit.
Okay.
And it's. About 18 people that go and attempt to climb K2, the mountain, the second highest mountain in the world.
Sure.
And it talks about the people that made it up there and the people that didn't make it up there, the people that made it up there and didn't make it back down. It was a really interesting movie. I have no ties to any kind of mountain climbing or mountainous, yeah, anything like that. But it was a really interesting movie. And what brought me to it was... I think it was some clickbait or something on Facebook, but somebody was talking about climbing Mount Everest, and they said how some people you literally walk by
bodies. Yeah.
And I was reading an article about it, and then next thing you know, that led me to somewhere else, which then brought me to the summit, which very much touches on that.
Okay.
About deaths and the dangers and the amount of people that try to climb, whether it's Mount Everest or K2 or other mountains. And I'd say it's an interesting movie. So, The Summit. And our good friend, Steve Held, per my recommendation, went out and watched it, and he very much enjoyed it as well.
Nice.
How about you?
I don't. I'm trying to think. I'm racking my brain for things that I have watched or done. It's been a lot of, the regular same stuff. And with the holidays, lots of travel. I've been I've been playing a lot of Spider Solitaire on my iPad lately.
Wow.
Yeah, it's just in my downtime, which isn't very much, but I don't.
What I'd like to know, since I was turned on to the game, as we've talked about before, 2048, I would like to know if any of our Smashies play it, and I'd like to know what your high score is.
Oh.
And or the best block you've gotten.
I prefer threes, but...
Whatever. I don't know what that is, but...
It's very similar, but probably... I think it's a little bit nicer from what I've seen. But same thing.
2048, I'd like to know.
I think Star Wars was my pick. Was it 2 weeks ago? I had seen it. If you haven't seen it, I mean, if that wasn't my pick, yes, go see Star Wars. It's going to be the... Do you feel left out? Because it's going to be the biggest movie in history.
Okay.
Period.
I'm okay with that.
It'll be the biggest domestic. It'll be the biggest international. It will be the largest movie until probably the next Star Wars.
Okay.
Do you feel left out at all not seeing it?
Not really.
Okay.
I
know you're not a sci-fi guy.
Because I'm not really... I haven't been vested or invested in the previous six. I'm familiar with them, but not truly vested in them. I'm also very much, I've come to learn that I'm very much a guy that loves to, if I get on board with something, I'm okay with getting on board with it late.
Yeah. That's fine.
I'm still tight rolling my jeans. I still got my hypercolor shirts. I'm okay with adapting to a trend, even if it's months or years after the fact, or if it's come and gone. And sure, there is some stuff that talk about, as I see the boards lighting up regarding the
movies
whole Disney and you know the involvement and all that other stuff, but I also don't always buy into the masses and the mass appeal,
yeah,
like argument side of things.
No, I'm
because my references always come back to, and I'm sure I'll offend a few here. My references always come back to NASCAR is like the number one watched thing out there.
It used to be. I don't know. If
country
it still
music's
is.
The number one music in the world.
Oh,
and I'm not on board with either.
All right, Star Wars, go see it. It was good. I'll say this. It wasn't great. I think the best movie of the year, of last year, was Mad Max Fury Road. Just a phenomenal movie. But Star Wars was good. It's a good launching platform. I think you're going to see some really great movies, especially with the next two coming out, Episode 8 and 9, both written by Ryan Johnson, who wrote... Have you seen Looper?
What was that
with
where he like could go into different like time holes or warps or something? No, or am I
no, that's
of?
Where it's
excuse me.
No, that's fine. You're coughing. I'm totally drawing blanks on names.
I gotta Google Looper.
No, but basically the kid from Third Rock from the Sun.
Yeah, okay.
And Bruce Willis.
Haley Joel Osment.
No. Third Rock from the Sun, the other one. The one he does 500 Days of Summer now, and he's in a Samsung commercial. I'm totally blanking on his name.
I think
thank you. Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Yeah. Thank you, Dion. I just couldn't grab it. Anyway, basically it's, you know, he comes back in the future, from the future, and it's a really great movie. But he's writing the next two Star Wars, so I'm super excited about it because he's a phenomenal director. He's directing the next one and writing the next two.
Who is
The guy who did Looper, Ryan Johnson. I
believe his name.
Okay. So I have really high hopes. But my pick, if you want this week, go out and listen to, if you're a fan of country music, which I am normally not.
What?
I know I'm not. A band released an album, a band called The Possum Posse.
So clever.
They're out of Austin.
The Possum Posse.
They're kind of country. They're out of, like I said, they're a kind of rockabilly a little bit, but it's a really good album. You know me as well as anybody. The closest to country I probably get is Taylor Swift. And even that, I don't own a single album. And if it comes on the radio, I don't turn it off is about as much as I can promote that. So but yeah, the Possum Posse out of Austin, really good. They do a great live show. I've seen a couple videos, but their new album is a good solid quality effort, so go ahead and give them some props.
To answer you, Michael Gibney, I believe,
yeah, I get everyone in there saying I don't like country either. This is not exactly country. It's way more fun than that. So
To answer your question, though, Michael, I believe that Johnny V's mic was actually considerably more than mine.
Yes.
In terms of cost.
Well, yours is free because I stole it from work.
Well, besides that.
And mine was a couple hundred bucks. $200? I don't recall what I paid
so
for it.
The question would be, what was this new?
Maybe this was $300. I think maybe the whole rig together was $400 with the arm and everything. New, I bet you that was probably $70 to $100.
So Michael says mine's much clearer.
This is a different mic. Yours is a side address mic. Yours also picks up a lot more room noise. And
I'm prettier.
And you're prettier. Makes your head look less fat.
I don't know. Wish it did.
So, yeah, yours is a side address. It also picks up a lot. Like I said, it picks up a lot. When he types, you can hear it a lot better and things like that. So,
yeah, his chair is better. Mine is literally...
I'm overweight. When we saw Kat Newley's phone fly up, that's going to happen to Terry at some point because he's on an old kitchen chair of mine that we don't really use anymore. But
it's definitely going to come crashing down.
Whereas
at
mine
some
is
point.
Like this old, it's like a 50s style chair that my wife refinished, so to speak. So, yeah. Yay.
All right. Anything else that we have? It seems like your headphones should be switched to match your mics.
So because I have the nicer mic, I should have the nicer headphones.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I'll eventually get some nice headphones, or maybe I'll get some in ear ones that no one can see. Nah.
That'd be
lame.
Amazing. So we should talk about Obama and
we don't talk politics hardly ever unless you want to listen to the politics podcast, which is really funny, and it's not political, but it's about politics, so kind of just keeps you up to date on what's going on in a very humorous way. But I know nothing about what he's done right now. And I'm gonna right now stay that way for the next couple days until I finally dig in. I just don't have time to. I'm not going to say anything ignorant.
No, correct. And I was just kidding. I don't want to.
I know.
Dan Nelson asked, who do you guys think ESPN will have doing commentary at Worlds this year and calling the shots? Well, a couple clarifications there. As far as I know, ESPN and Worlds are not an effort at the moment. Yeah, so Steve Mills is clarifying that. As far as I know, unless there's something that's happened that nobody's told us about, ESPN is not related to Worlds in any way, shape, or form. No. ESPN 3 is where the American Disc Golf Tour's 5 holes will be broadcast. So Billy Crump is the lead commentator, so to speak, and he will be calling the shots probably along with someone else. But May 15th, I believe at 2 p.m., I don't know if that's Central or Eastern, but May 15th on ESPN 3, that's where you'll find Billy Crump in the American Disc Golf Tour. Something I was talking about recently was the fact that the American Disc Golf Tour, I know, I think it's El Guapo. I apologize if I'm ruining
El Guapo, like the criminal from Three Amigos?
They make baskets. El Guapo, there you go. Not El Guapo. El Guapo baskets.
So it is like the bad guy in Three Amigos.
Apparently. They had put on their website, and I just saw this a few days ago, so I reached out to them as well. They had said that they were attempting to be involved with the American Disc Golf Tour. However, their brand new top quality baskets didn't meet the American Disc Golf Tour specs.
Yeah, you'd said these because he was going to have to do something.
Yeah, I thought that was really interesting.
Did he say why they didn't meet the specs?
I just said, I'm curious to know how your baskets don't fit their standards. Are your baskets PDGA standard approved? And he had written back here on the Facebook saying his pro basket is PDGA championship approved. In order to be on ESPN, they're requiring a certain style of target per their gold standard specs.
So what does that mean?
I don't know. And that's when I reached out to him and said, hey, I'd be more than happy to review your basket if you want to send me one. So I'm not certain, but here's another little update. I believe I read that on the 15th is when they are going to be announcing who's signed up for the tour thus far. January 15th.
Okay.
I was talking with Dana Mite earlier today. He was super excited, he said, to hear of more people and of the details. But I believe on the 15th is when we're going to see who's all signed up for that. So we'll see what kind of Billy Crump's going to be doing the commentating. And I know he's been actively recruiting players. So hopefully he's getting some people over there.
Larry Puckett asks or says, didn't Macbeth say he was skipping the American tour? He's not necessarily skipping the American tour. He's not going, but he's not actively skipping it. He just has other things going on.
Yeah, I think he has I'm not sure if he has a direct conflict or if he wasn't looking to participate. But
yeah, because he'll be on the other side of the country.
Long and short of it is he will not be there.
Because is that the weekend after the World Tour or 2 weekends after the World Tour? I forget.
I'd have to look it up. Yeah. I know it's May 14th and 15th. I know.
I mean, yeah.
I think
there was something going on.
There's something the week before or after is what it was. Disc Golf Nerd says, what's up, Smashies? So glad you could join us. Thank you. He is actively skipping it. And one way or another, he's basically stated that he's not going to be participating in it. Most of the other pros are skipping it as well. And that's what's going to be interesting
to
see.
It's going
to
see who makes it, who doesn't. Right now, clearly, their number two player in the world, Ricky, is actively promoting it.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to be there. It for whoever said that it'll take away from winning if Macbeth isn't there, I disagree.
Yeah.
Just no more than
Macbeth can't be at every tournament.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, no more than any other event. So, no, you just... You win an event. You win an event with Ricky there, so.
Yeah, it should be really interesting. I think he also had reached out to Cam Todd.
Masters Cup is the week after, so crossing the country for that probably isn't in the.
Cards. Well, I'll say this: May. Now I'm really going to put my scheduling to the test. Last weekend in April is going to be glass blown. Then May 7th and 8th is the Kansas City Wide Open. The 14th and 15th, you know, as Paul had said, there's the Utah event along with some other events. But the 14th and 15th weekend is the Women's Global Event weekend. And then also the weekend for the American Disc Golf Tour. And then, yes, the 20th through the 22nd, I believe, is the Masters Cup Pro weekend. And the following weekend after that is the St. Jude Invitational weekend. Then there's a weekend sort of kind of off. And then 2 weeks later is the Beaver State Fling.
Wow.
I'm sick of looking at dates. I'm sick of looking at schedules. The only funny part that comes from it, or the only useful part that comes out of it, is within a few weeks, somebody can literally rattle off like any day, like June 19th. And I'll know usually within a few seconds of thinking, oh, that's a Thursday, because I know what the weekend was closest to it.
Sure.
So I can tell you what day of the week a date falls on. But that's only from looking at too many schedules. All right, do we got anything else that's out there, Terry? Where are you staying when you're here for Arizona for the Maricopa? Chris, I would love to stay with you. No, that actually technically has not been hashed out yet. I think I come into town Friday morning. I want to say I get there about 9:50 for all those stalkers out there. I believe I get into the Phoenix airport around 9:50 Friday morning. I'm looking to hang out at the tournament, check out the course, you know, get some interviews in with our players and do all that during Friday. And honestly, I don't believe right now that I have anything officially lined up for lodging accommodations for Friday and Saturday night. So I don't know if you have a hookup or a connection or otherwise, but I would be open ears to that.
Is Smashbox coming to Texas this year? Currently, we are not scheduled for anything live in Texas.
At the moment, yeah.
At the moment.
That
could always change.
Yeah, we have had conversations with our friend Matt Seary.
Yep.
And the Nick Hyde. I know he wants to make bigger and better this year. And one of the things he had discussed that we've discussed with him, is the possibility of live coverage. So
we have discussed it.
That weekend is open and on my calendar as being involved with the Nick Hyde. It's just going to be a matter of in what capacity. So there's your answer, Joe, as to us coming to Texas.
Deanna is asking about, I'm sure it's Beaver State Fling coverage. There will be no live coverage of Beaver State Fling just because of the location of the courses are in complete dead zones for almost all cellular. Milo McIver Park is null. So, but there's always post stuff. So
yeah, I'm unsure as to how that's going to unfold. Edited rounds, possibly. That's going to be a conversation. A lot of people like to be at that event. A lot of people like to cover that event. It's an amazing event. I'm not sure.
I'm
not sure personally. And I know there'll be coverage of some kinds. I'm just not sure as to who's going to be providing it. Maybe me, maybe others, maybe collaborations, who knows, but I'm sure there'll be some kind of coverage. They've been relatively hands-off. It seems as if in terms of the coverage where their event is like, well, if you're here to cover it, great. And if you're not, then so be it. You know, they're going to put on a good event either way. And yes, Matt Seary, our good friend, is very, very baby-faced. I complimented him instantly, though. Matt has.
Oh, did he shave?
Oh, yeah. And he looks very different. And I think he looks great. I think he looks really professional. And it's a nice new look for him. So here is, I'll show you a quick.
Yep,
there's Matt.
I'm seeing a picture of Matt.
And let's find the one he posted just a few days ago.
Is that right there, that corner shot?
Yeah, there you go. And there he is. He literally
Amazing.
Looks like a totally different person.
He does. He completely looks like a different person.
So he says he's happy, ready and happy for a new year and new motivation, new look, new goals. So we wish him the best.
People are calling out your Mountain Dew. Have you had
Mountain
Dew?
Oh, good call. I am still
Mountain Dew free.
On the wagon, I guess. Mountain Dew free. Thank you. I appreciate it. Clearly the next logical step is, and I was better at this years ago, was when I eliminated Mountain Dew, I actually eliminated all soda. This time, I did it a little slower. I eliminated Mountain Dew, and I just have cut way back on soda.
I say, what other soda are you drinking?
I dabble. I enjoy Cherry Coke. Especially if it's freshly, mixed. Even though that grenadine's like the worst thing in the world for you.
Yeah, I'm a Coke fan.
So Cherry Coke, I'm a fan of, and I've acquired a taste for Dr. Pepper in the last 5 years.
Yeah,
it's kind of weird.
Growing up, we had we would go over to a buddy, my friend Terry's house, not you, another friend Terry, and for whatever reason, his parents bought Dr. Pepper, so they would have a refrigerator stocked usually with 8 to 10, 12 packs. And we had free,
that's what the doctor ordered.
We had free reign of it as kids. So, and this is high school. So we would go there and we'd play cards, and that's where I never liked it until then. But when it's the only thing you can drink and you're a high school teenager, you'd start grabbing, and I eventually I liked it. Like I never disliked it, but I grew fond of it. Now when I drink it, that's what I think of. So
yeah, it's grown on me a little bit, but the next logical step is ultimately no soda, of course. That's a no-brainer. Everybody knows that. But maybe at least calorie-free soda. And then everyone's going to argue that aspartame and all the stuff they put in there and the sweeteners are actually worse for you than whatever. I should just quit drinking soda. And I'll say I've cut back. I mean, alone, I did the math the other day. The tens of thousands of calories I didn't consume in the last 30 days or so of Mountain Dew was replaced with a few thousand calories of other soda. But still not the Mountain Dew. So I'm off the Dew as of now. Crystal Pepsi is the bomb, McCoy says. You know what's really good is clearly Canadian. Clearly Canadian. That's an old school. That's an eighth grade reference for you and I.
It is.
Oh, man. Pepsi Clear. Those were.
Yep.
That was funny when those. Surge, no. Yuck. I was never a Surge fan. Jolt. Now, if you want to get serious,
you skip Surge, you go right to Jolt. Have you ever had a Jolt?
Jolt. Yeah.
I'll say I had. Oh, yeah. I've had one in my life. There was a book report. It was a book review, is what we called it in ninth grade with Mr. Lee.
Mr. Lee. Yep.
My Terry and I went to the same junior high, so I had him for English.
I had him for government.
Yep. I had him government as well and English. He did advanced English, which I hated. And so we'd have to write these 15 to 20 page book reports. And of course, I'm a procrastinator to no end. I show up and I'm thinking, I got this. I can write it in 2 days. I read the book. And then, of course, 2 days goes by and then I have 1 day to write it. So I went to the store and I bought one Jolt and I drank it. And I wrote like a 15 to 20 page book report on the book The Pearl, I believe it's a Steinbeck book, back when I was in ninth grade. And that was the only Jolt I've ever had.
Wow. I could get down with some of that right now.
Yeah.
Just for fun. I'm a badass.
It was not good. I also won a radio contest that night for something because I was listening to the radio all night.
Sure.
And I called in at like 3 a.m. and I won and I never picked up whatever I won. So,
huh?
Because I had no way to get to the radio station when you're in ninth grade.
Some old school stuff. Jolly Good. If you're gonna go Jolly Good, you could go even cheaper and go Wildwood.
Yeah,
that was the cheapest of the cheap at the grocery stores.
Yep, Jolly Good is. I think Jolly Good's pretty local for the Midwest.
Okay, that I would believe that. Jolly Good sounds like something the Midwest would come up with.
We're Jolly Good.
RC Cola. I was an RC fan at one point. My grandma kept RC and 7-Up. It's like there was a bottler there, and there wasn't. So yeah. I don't know how that was a kick for her.
Dion asks, we were talking earlier about what ciders do I drink. I'm not very picky about the ciders. I had Woodchuck for the longest time before there were options.
Yep.
When it was the cider to drink,
yep,
really.
Yep.
So I usually get that once a year when we go up to Northwoods. The Red Apple, is that what it is?
Red's Apple Ale.
Red's Apple Ale.
Which now has like 19 different flavors, I think.
Really?
Yeah. It's.
I don't know. I drink cider so little. I don't drink any beer, but I drink cider so little. This past weekend, at New Year's Eve, I was drinking, I think it was straight whiskey. Like just in a cup with some, with some ice cubes. That's what the gentleman whose house we were at had. So.
I'm familiar with Faygo. That is in various parts of the country. I know I've seen it in various places anyways. What do you guys think about safari rounds?
An actual golf horrible. Question. You don't like safari rounds?
Well, back up. Do you mean safari like final nines or safari rounds for spectators and gallery? Or do you mean like you and your three buddies go out to your local course and you just make a bunch of safari holes? Those are two totally different scenarios.
Well, so tell me how you think either.
Well, when it's you and your buddies and you play a local course and you're just looking for a change of pace and you want to play some safari holes and you hole threes tee to nines basket and you play all these other random holes, as long as it's not busy with a bunch of other people in your way that you may kill that don't know what you're doing and don't realize that you're just playing wherever you want, I'm a big fan of it. I think it's fun. I think it's a good way to change things up. Good time. Safari holes during any serious competitive play, I think, suck. And the number one reason, it's maybe a little odd, but the number one reason is relatability. I don't think you've just played you've played a course for 4 rounds. You're an amateur or you're a pro. If you've played a course for 4 rounds, you've played those 18 holes 4 times, mm-hmm. and now you're going to go throw from one's tee to 14's basket, because that's just what makes sense. You, in your head, you can line it up, and maybe the TD figured out it's roughly 700 feet, but you can't necessarily relate to it, because you never threw that. You didn't play it. You could say, well, here's what I think I would do, but where they land and what they do, I just don't feel is nearly as relatable. I'd rather see them go play the same holes I just played.
Yeah.
There's so much more to learn by that. There's so much more to appreciate, because when you see that Paul Ulibarri just threw his putter on an Annie line to get around these trees on hole 2, which might only be 290, but he took a route I would have never thought of. To me, that's so much more valuable, and I can relate to it.
And I don't mind safari.
So I hate safari holes.
See, I don't mind safari for exhibition, like skins or match play or something like that. Something where it's not a regular tournament round. I don't like safari. Like, you know, you play 4 rounds at a course and then the final nine is safari. I'm not a big fan of that. I would rather. Now, if you tell me the final nine doesn't count towards the tournament and they're playing for skins, I have no problem with that.
Even still, though.
Go for it.
Because I still am like, meh, what does that mean to me? He just threw that shot out in the middle of the field. And half the time, and here's another big problem with it.
See, to me, that's no different than walking up to a course I don't know and watching.
Yeah, but a lot. Well, yeah, but you just probably played in that course. And secondly, I think a lot of the time, the holes aren't good.
No, you're right. 9 times out of 10.
Oh, here's a 4. I bet you, if you logged every safari hole ever played since, we'll say, the year 2000, and you logged every safari hole played at an A tier or whatever, you'd find that more often than not, the number one score is a 4.
Yeah. Yep.
Just because it truly wasn't a 3 for these guys.
They just lengthened it.
Or it was a tap-in 4. You know, I hate it.
Yeah, no,
they're usually pretty boring too, in that sense.
I agree.
They're supposed to showcase and highlight the skills rarely do the holes.
They usually highlight distance. That's usually what it is.
Maybe.
So
that's
it seems to be pretty well what most people are saying, that that Safari in a tournament is lame.
Roger wants to know, would it be better to throw a final nine layout shorter so you can get those ace runs and get gettable holes to make it more suspenseful? I've said it before. I want to see people birdie holes and that's a sign of them playing it well. If you play nine final nine holes and every hole was under 300 feet, but it was a decent hole, I wouldn't care.
Yeah.
I'd be okay with that. I want to see people score, or I want to see Paul Ulibarri park nine of those holes and still lose by two because the other guy parked nine or whatever. You still need to throw the shots. And I think regardless of how challenging the hole is, I want to see these people throw good shots. I don't know. I feel like Safaris and all these other things just usually like, let's put a bunch more distance on it. That'll make it so much. No, it just drags everyone's day out longer.
Yeah, and then
I'm sick of recording you. Well, I'm sick of walking around.
Even I was gonna say there's a tournament here in Wisconsin, the Standing Rocks Open, that is a final nine for skins. They take the best four scores of any division, and you get to play in this skins match.
From the weekend.
From the weekend.
There's two previous rounds on one of the courses. Yeah.
So the West Course, which is the long course and
more challenging
course, they take the best round out of that one. So whatever. It's a long final nine. Like those holes are long. You walk around. I've given up. After the tournament, I sit in the chalet and we play cards and wait for the final nine to get in. Because 99% chance none of the people I play with are making it. Occasionally, I think Steve has made it once and whatever. But it's just those long, long, long holes are just not interesting. The only interesting one is down the ski hill for me. Just watching the guys crush what probably amounts to a 1,500-foot hole down that,
yeah,
down that ski hill. So
I don't know.
But other than that.
More often than not, I don't feel like they're well-designed. And I'm not saying I could necessarily. I guess if I tried to, I could probably go out and come up with some good ones. So just more often than not, though, they're not really well designed. People are just like, oh, let's just throw from this tee to that basket. It'll be kind of cool. Yeah, sure, kind of,
yeah,
at best. urban golf, I'll say I have not participated in enough urban golf, so to speak. I would love to. I mean, if it's allowed and it's cool, and I know down in North Carolina they have theirs. I know Schwebe obviously was just in that urban golf event, like, I think that's awesome, and I would love to participate in it, especially in a legitimate legal capacity. Sometimes they're not always on the up and up, but I think it could be bad publicity unless the city and everyone else is bought into it.
Yeah, unless everyone buys into it.
Yeah.
And one of the things I didn't bring up with Paul and Kat when we were talking about worlds and finals and everything like that is one of the things I think I'm going to miss. And I understand these pros don't want to play five different courses. I get that. But just there are so few courses that have enough variety
to challenge all aspects of anyone's game.
To challenge all aspects. I kind of like this. I have a soft spot in my heart for the six-round worlds.
Sure.
That have like three courses.
Yeah.
Because it literally will challenge almost every aspect of your game at some point.
Amongst
those three courses. Usually. We've been pretty fortunate in the past, but that's something I'm going to miss. And I understand the reasons for it. I understand that these guys don't want to have to practice three or four courses, and it's a pain to drive all that way. You know, you might have a good course, but it's an hour and a half away, so these guys have to get in a car, and it might only be for one round. But still, I get that, and I completely understand. It just hurts a little bit to be like, okay, congratulations, you're playing Blue Ribbon Pines. And what you can crush, all right, there you go, you're gonna win. Or maybe not Blue Ribbon Pines particularly, but
Blue Valley,
that's what I'm thinking of. Blue Valley, you can crush, congratulations, you're gonna win. Like it's so less interesting to me as a spectator, but I understand why they're doing it.
Yeah, and I think you hit it on the head with there's so few courses that can really challenge so many components of your game. And you know, I look back at the Worlds this year, in Pennsylvania, and I look at Slippery Rock and the 10 or 12 or 15,000 feet that that course was, with being primarily open, you know, lots of, you know, some hills elevation, but a little bit more open than a lot of the other courses. And I just feel like every course had a little bit different taste and a little bit different feel to it. And if you're limiting the courses, I mean, I think you have to have at least two, but if you're limiting the courses, everyone is easily going to then go to, oh, well, that was his style course.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, look at Avery Jenkins, who busted out this, you know, his lead at the 2009 Worlds, and it was conveniently on one of the longest courses the Worlds has ever seen.
Yeah, and at the time he was one of the, and he still is a far thrower, but at the time he was almost the furthest throwing golfer.
Yeah, exactly.
Like,
so,
like, people could, some people could outdistance him, but as far as actual golf shots, he could crush. And I'm not saying that's why he won, but I mean, because clearly his putting was on that week and whatnot. But yeah, that's just the limited style. I'm hoping, you know, because what if it's a, are people going to complain if it's a really tight wooded course?
Yeah,
you know,
they're going to say, well, my distance, I didn't get to,
I didn't get to rely on. Simon, we'll just say Simon, even though he said he prefers tight courses. You know, oh, that didn't suit my game because I, you know, I throw far. Brinster's going to win this or something along those lines. Or you get out to a wide open crusher course, and then everyone's, then, you know, who's a.
Well, and it's funny though too, because right now though, that argument's not really made at, say, a USDGC, and maybe because there is such an abundance of OB rope, but at USDGC that's primarily open, but it doesn't necessarily focus on a far thrower. Very few of those players are throwing at 100% capacity, you know, 100% power. So it's interesting to see how it's all going to shake out.
Yeah, and then, like what Dion says, that's why the courses are so important. And I hope that we will see a variety of courses, some good shots. I like watching wooded golf. Watching the Pennsylvania, watching Paul just pure some of those shots was phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
The Slippery Rock course, was that the one at the college?
Yep.
That was kind of boring to me. Like, there were some really cool shots at the final hole. There was, like, four really cool shots out there that I saw. And the other ones, were to me, were kind of like, okay, he's going to throw far.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that's just, that was my opinion.
Country Disc Golf says, in terms of the courses, the Hall of Fame Classic, where Michael Johansson was lacing shots through the trees and hitting great lines, was my favorite tourney to watch this year. I would totally agree with you. And
yeah.
Even though I'm older and washed up at this point, I can appreciate that golf more than anyone. To watch a 400 foot.
Look what Michael Joe did in Charlotte at some of those courses.
Exactly. To watch a 400 foot laced shot is just, it's just so beautiful by MJ or by whomever. It's definitely some of the best golf to watch, in my opinion. How would you not like wooded golf? You have to play your shot times 10 plus the win. How can you not like the wooded golf? Kevin says his Open Worlds days are probably over. I know what you're saying, Kevin.
Keep trying.
You're on the board, so we're going to call you out. Any media landscape, any change in the media landscape that, you know, us two studs are should know about here? Things like people ask us all the time as to what's happening with the Pro Worlds coverage next year. We haven't been asked yet. Nobody's written a check to us. But people want to know what's going on with Pro Worlds coverage next year and other events. So if you've got any insight, we would love to hear it because we really don't know.
Maple Hill would be a great course for a Worlds.
The main
one, because that covers most of your game. Littlewood, there's not as much open distance out there. I'd like to see two or three just crusher holes, which it doesn't truly have. It's got hole 18 where you can kind of lay into a drive, but then after that you kind of have to lay up, which is fine. But yeah,
Mills and Dion are having discussion as to which course they're referring to as to the wooded and tight and lines and fluky or not. And there's clearly always that fine line between too wooded and fluky versus
defined fairways versus not defined
and
fairways.
Technically thrown shots versus poke and hope or throw and pray or whatever.
For you and I think a lot of people might see this hopefully all you will see this year, the Manitowoc course, there is a signature hole, the lighthouse hole,
mm-hmm.
which I think is a great hole, with the exception of one tree sitting right in the middle of that fairway. There's one little birch tree 3/4 of the way down the fairway, right in the middle.
I've never touched it.
And
it's funny. I can't even think of it.
Yeah, it's just...
I think that hole's clear enough.
It's pretty clear. But it's that kind of thing where people think that one tree in the fairway, we're like, well, yeah, it's so far down there. Well, yeah, it's so far down there. It makes a hole fluky. Just give me a clean fairway from wherever you want me to shoot to wherever you want me to land. Like, it doesn't have to be next to the basket, but give me, if it's a two-shot hole, that's fine. Just give me a clean line.
Don't get me started on some other courses then. So anyway, Kevin McCoy replies, saying, we are approving the budget currently. We have empowered Marty to make the call on that. And he's referencing Media Marty Gregoire. So I guess Marty and I will have a conversation of sorts.
Yeah.
I'd love to know where that's...
Let's shake him down.
Where that's going to go and what's going to happen with that. Again, there's just so many questions, so much speculation. I'd love to throw our hat in the ring that we've 15 live events over the last 2 years.
Boom.
Along with 68 podcasts. They're still having conversations about different courses regarding Idlewild. Steve Mills isn't a fan. One of the questions or comments out there is he doesn't think that Maine or the New England could have a Worlds-like atmosphere. I'm not sure about that. I mean,
it might be. Again, we're going to say that in the future, the Worlds atmosphere is going to be different. I think Maine could do a Pro Worlds.
Yeah.
I don't think they could maybe pull off an Am Worlds just because of, and I don't know the Maine area, but it sounds like there's a few courses. And there might not be the central location that you need for an Am Worlds. But for a Pro Worlds, you're going to see less extras. You're going to see less of the... You might get a player's party, and that might be it. Who knows? And a fly mart.
Beats asks, took a few weeks off. How has the podcast... It's been effing awesome.
Yeah, it's been the greatest thing that you probably haven't listened to.
Yes. So, yeah. I don't know where you've been, but... actually, we were off last week, for those that didn't already know. We were off last week, and then we're back here this week and for the foreseeable future, still on Tuesday nights. McCoy says, Pro Worlds may end up being on attempt courses at resorts if they spend enough. That certainly could be an idea as well.
Yeah.
And I'm sure one or two designers would be brought in and then could certainly administer that.
Yeah, I think some really cool resorts... could be interesting. I didn't really think about that.
Yeah, if you temp
courses.
Yeah, I mean, you look at your Smuggler's Notch.
If you're only doing one course, or maybe two, you could maybe squeeze in there.
Well, if you're looking, and I think of a Smuggler's Notch, which obviously will be hosting their own event and then hosting the Pro Tour finale all in September. That's a perfect situation where they have all the lodging right there on site. They have more than enough land. In that case, there's two courses already there. But even if they didn't, they would be able to put something up possibly for the week to host a Pro Worlds. And it's just such an amazing place. The Japan Open model. Yeah, that too. And I think of, the one thing I would say is I'm kind of over the ball golf course integration, and it's because of all the reasons we just spoke of when we talk about good courses and courses that we like to see. I like to see something wooded, at least mildly wooded, and just far too often golf courses don't lend to that.
I was going to say Japan Open had some nice, some decently accurate needing shots. There were a few. It wasn't all
it's far from wooded.
Crushing. It's far from wooded. Agreed. But there were some smaller fairways, we'll say, as opposed to some of the wide open ones. But I agree with you in that some of the ball golf courses get boring because it's the same thing. It's all right, we're gonna put a basket next to a bunker, and so you can't run at it, and they're gonna be very long, and we're gonna put rope up so that you have to stay in a certain spot.
Yeah,
it just gets old. Like, you want to put up 3 or 4 holes like that, awesome. The whole thing though.
Yeah, Beats 1982 asked, why can't Japan get a Worlds event? No one would go. That's the problem. They certainly could host it. They certainly have the skills, the management, the resources. It could all get done. The problem is so very, very, very few people will actually go to compete in it because it's going to cost you anywhere from, you know, if Worlds used to cost you $1,000 or $2,000 to go, you know, you're going to double that by being in Japan.
At least plane tickets are anywhere from $1,500 exactly. to $2,000.
So that's what I'm saying. That's the problem, is that no one would ultimately go to it. So they continue to say the World Championships has only been, I think, in Canada once or twice, and then obviously in the U.S. here outside of that. And I've played in 20 consecutive Worlds. I can't say how many people would actually travel outside the U.S. to go compete in them.
Brody says, plus they'd have to use 150-class discs. I don't know if you could. I think you could make an exception for Worlds.
Correct.
You could figure that out if it's on a resort. It's exactly. not a public course. You could probably work those details out.
I bet we see a Worlds in Europe by 2025.
Yeah.
That I could believe, especially with what UC and the rest of that crew is doing. But, rewind 25 years ago and just wasn't going
to
happen. And
I see your 2025. I raise you to 2021.
What year is it?
No, 2022. So 5 years from now.
I don't know. Yeah, that's possible. And now we're definitely in a different climate and culture and atmosphere than we were 10 years ago when we only had 5 touring pros or 8 touring pros going around eating ramen. Now we have 30 touring pros going around eating ramen, except for a few. But more people are a little bit more inclined. But it's still not going to be the mass appeal that we get when you put it in Emporia or Peoria, either or.
Yeah, either one.
So we'll see how that all Manitowoc Worlds. That's not going to happen. That world's already crashed down on us. No. Manitowoc Worlds, there's just not enough good courses there in Manitowoc.
Well,
for a Pro Worlds.
For Pro Worlds, they're...
No.
I don't know.
No. Sorry, I'll be blunt. No. I don't think there are.
If it's future Pro Worlds, think about it. When we're down to one division or two divisions,
you're
only doing one or two courses.
I think you need at least two courses, and I don't think there's... If you... If you're going to just say one course, there's no one course that suits everyone there.
Correct.
And if you're going to say two courses, there's no two courses that are both up to Pro Worlds caliber.
I will agree with that. Now, if you know, knowing Jim up there, he might be able to put together a temporary course or something like that. But, yeah.
Why doesn't Ramen sponsor disc golf? They might be the one thing that's too cheap to sponsor us, maybe. I mean...
They probably are rolling in it.
Yeah. Come on, Terry. You say, Roger, I'm a realist, buddy. No, I'm just a realist, and I've been around the block a long
time. Rolling Ridge is a great venue, but it's not enough.
Correct. Yeah, just the reality of it there. All righty. Let's see if I got anything else on the... I was going to check in and see if we got any updates from Ricky. He should be out of his movie. I think the Ricky movie review...
That could be priceless.
I would love to have it. That's all. I would love to have Ricky out there.
So Kevin says that they are shooting for two course model, so they can get 200 plus open players.
Okay.
And I hope that shrinking the event increases the players, the number of players that we get, because you know being able to go for only 4 days. As opposed to, you know, an 8-7 day or whatever you had to go for Worlds trip might be better.
No response. A very interesting movie and eye-opening. Would recommend to anyone and everyone.
It's a movie I heard that people were like, you walk out and you want to just tear somebody apart because you're thinking like, how unfair is this?
Oh, I'm definitely interested in seeing it.
It's one of the ones that I won't go to the theater and see it, but it's like a Netflix or something else.
Scott there is already creeping on his page and got the info as well. And McCoy is clarifying MPO, FPO only.
That's what the Pro Worlds will
be. Yeah, correct. All right.
The movie's called the movie they were talking about is The Big Short. It's I believe it's a movie about Wall Street. And There was something else, but it's a Wall Street movie it looks like it's a period piece from the 80s.
It's about America and the banking system collapsing, is how Ricky set it up for everyone.
Yeah. I don't know what year it's based out of. I don't know if it was the original savings and loan scandal or if it's more recent, like the mid-2000s, to be honest. So,
I was posed with a transgender, disc golf transgender-related question today. Someone had reached out to me, and thanks to our good friend, CK34, Chuckles. Chuck Kennedy had then referenced me to the correct media piece. I'm going to see if I can pull it up again. I believe it's, I don't want to misquote myself, so I won't even do that. The Stockholm Consensus, it's called. So if you're interested in learning about how it gets addressed and what that really means for someone that may be, I was going to say converting. I don't think that's the right word. Transitioning. From male to female or vice versa, whatever. The Statement of Stockholm Consensus on Sex Reassignment in Sports. And that is what the PDGA also adheres to.
So okay.
For anyone that's ever been interested or wants to know, that's what you can reference. And that's a pretty widely referenced and accepted model and document, I think, just across. I think it even says the IOC, the International Ad Hoc Committee convened by the IOC Medical Commission in Stockholm, blah, blah, blah. So for anyone that needs to know or cares, that's you can reference that piece. It's also found in the pdga.com/files section. So it's out there for everyone.
Awesome.
Yeah, just kind of. I know that's totally random.
But no, but it's
something worth noting because I knew I had a conversation about it 8 or 5, 6, 7 years ago with someone, and then when somebody asked me about it today, I'm like, I know we have a stance, I know we have a position on it, I know we have a document on it, and again, thanks to Chuck Kennedy, he was kind enough to point me in the direction. Chuck, like Beetlejuice, just say his name 3 times and
he shows up.
Shows up and has an answer. Steve, I'll let you. Steve Mills is asking on the board as to if Caitlyn Jenner can play.
FPO.
I'm in FPO. I'm not going to make any of my interpretation on here. Just like I told the person that was inquiring, I don't want to make my interpretation. I would say go out and read this document, and then you can make the interpretation. And there's things we don't know because it talks about hormones and it talks about reassignment surgeries, and unless you know something I don't, Mills, I'm not sure where Caitlin is at with some of that stuff.
Yeah. I will say that brings me to 2 subjects.
Uh-oh. Wow.
I know. One, I've heard really phenomenal great things about the Amazon series Transparent.
Okay.
Which is, are you familiar with it at all?
It rings a bell.
It's got Jeffrey Tambor in it, who was the dad from Arrested Development. And he's basically an older gentleman who is transitioning, I believe, to a woman, or chooses to. I haven't watched it yet, but I've heard nothing but good things about it, how it's a phenomenal series. It's pretty short. It's just started its 2nd season, I believe.
Hmm.
And that brings me to Amazon Video, which made me think of, I watched the 1st episode of Man in the High Castle, which was great, and I'm excited to dive back in now.
Hmm.
I watched it like a week ago. So I'm excited to kind of just dig in and watch some Man in the High Castle.
Jeffrey Tambor, which I don't think I realized that was his name. Obviously a very, very,
very famous,
famous actor. I never really sought out his name for any reason or needed it at the tip of my tongue. He plays so many interesting parts in so many. So
he was really comedy based for a while, and now he's really, it's in the past 10 years, branched out into a lot of different aspects.
Yeah, so definitely interested. That's something. Yeah, I didn't know anything about that, but it says recently nominated for 3 Golden Globes.
Yeah,
huh.
Yeah. It's had nothing but great reviews, and some of the people that I trust most are saying it's really good. Huh. So
I would be interested to go see it.
Do you have an Amazon Prime account?
I do.
Yeah, you could watch it then.
Prime is right. Steve Mills says he doesn't know any more than I do about Caitlin. I don't know. You might, Steve.
Steve rolls in the same circles.
anything. Steve's on the West Coast.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Because Steve's out in L.A. or something like that, isn't he? Or is he in Phoenix? Or
where are you now? He's in San Diego.
San Diego.
Living off his sponsor, his wife, he said earlier.
Good for you.
So, living large. All right. I don't know. Unless we have anything from the anything remaining, a good solid crowd sticking around for the after show. We appreciate you guys tuning in and getting a little bit of the live fix that we haven't been able to provide. We're going to be back on it, though, next week. Next week. So wrap up by saying next week, I think we're going to have a quick update by Val Jenkins at some point regarding the Women's Global event. So we're excited to, we're kind of partnering with that event, and we really want to help push it and promote it. I believe I'm helping or in charge of one of the local chapters, or at least helping with the local chapter for the Women's Global event.
Cool.
So excited to help out Val with that. We're going to have Ricky Singleton, not Ricky Wysocki. He's going to be here. He's going to be talking about Daredevil Discs. They've been gracious enough to support our podcast for the last 3 or 4 weeks. They're going to support it. He says possibly indefinitely, so that's awesome for them to say and to step up and do. And awesome. So we're going to learn more about Daredevil, which I think a lot of people have something to learn there, because they're not a household name yet. Nope. They're out of Canada, eh? I'm excited to learn more and to share more with the world as to what they have going on.
There's a lot of new disc companies out there. People are eating it up, so more
as
power
they should
to them.
Be. So we've got that going on, and then, like I said, in 2 weeks, we're going to be joined by Drew Gibson and possibly some other updates. So, yeah, lots of good stuff. And I'm checking out the board, which doesn't have anything else that we need at the moment. So we're almost right on the three-hour mark between the regular show and the after show.
A short show tonight.
Yeah, very nice. So this has, in fact, been podcast number 68's after show, the single best after show podcast in all of disc golf.
2016.
In 2016, we're the best that there is out there. We appreciate you guys for tuning in, checking us out, and coming along for the live ride. And for all those that are listening in your car or doing whatever else you're doing, we do appreciate it. So for Johnny V and myself, Terry Miller, the Disc Golf Guy, we'll see you guys next week for episode 69's podcast. We'll see you then when you step inside the Smashbox.